this.
Moses?
Yeah, I'm going to take CLG as well.
Okay, and Sadek?
Yeah, I think Moses touched on it as well with JDM because Kenny was off versus Waylander to get refrags. I'm going to go 2-1. I think it's going to be CLG.
Okay, well, thanks for your thoughts. You can enjoy Tequila Shot. Three Sucker Bliats going against Gambit Gaming. We're going to get into this game with Jason DDK.
That's a curse of that language. Jesus Christ.
Bro, not sure where to go with that. Happy birthday to Sadakist, I suppose.
Yep, that's quite a throw, to be honest.
I don't know what. Well, we're on cash, Dan. Let's move off, swiftly forward of that. We're on cash. We've got CLG versus Gambit, best of three. We've got Cobblers as the second map, but we'll start with the first. Gambit going to be on the T side. CLG starting on the favoured side of cash or cash, if you are from Australia, Dan.
Cash. That's all I have to add.
His music is mad epic.
Well, thanks for that, James. It is indeed Sadakist's birthday. So, CLG starting off on the CT side and Gambit on the T side here on Kaish. Shout out to the Aussies. And we can see that we're going to be getting a lot of presence here initially from Gambit, just moving towards the boost area into mid. The bomb is actually towards A main, so they're going to go for the A split right now. And so far, it's Adren and Dozier with the openers. CLG feeling the pain as the bomb makes its way onto the A site. And it's all on JDM and Hazed on a very, very difficult retake. Two versus five. No, well, two flashbangs. No Kevlar on Ace, but at least there's a kit.
All they need is headshots, Dan. They've got the USPs. They have the range. There are two USPs on the T side as well, though, so they're going to need to be quick on the trigger down, but by no means are they out on this pistol, though that smoke does definitely not help. JDM's got one. Four more to find. His teammates behind the smoke. He hears the flank coming in, and the trend's going to be successful with that, leaving Hazed alone versus four. Still got a bit of time. Does have a kit as well. That time is ticking fast. Waylander just searching in the smoke there, and I think the round is going to be over. The double slash triple peek coming in, and there's a bit of a whoop as Gambit take the first round.
Yep, so it means that CLG likely going to force it up here. It's definitely very viable just to not to go all the way for the entire team, except for maybe, you know, a couple players, but are they going to do it? I mean, JDM going to be sticking on a full eco, so he can actually get himself an AWP when they can eventually afford to buy, which is definitely very smart. Hayes as well, you know, not really investing too much. So only three... Okay, no, Hayes is going to go all the way as well, just a little bit later. So CLG in a round like this, really looking, of course, for a lot of damage onto Gambit's economy. Just keep them honest there. And we can see already a bit of firefight there in middle as Gambit take it over. And a boost onto Hayes here. And it looks like CLG are retaking middle. And there's a gun up for grabs there. It's only a MAC-10 though, so by design, Gambit are going to lose the MAC-10.
Yeah, well, they've lost another gun elsewhere as Hooch has left the building. So there's a man advantage for CLG. There is armor in play here on most of the players, save for JDM, who is indeed saving for an AWP. And that's a problem. The fact that they could pick up more weapons a bit later on is going to be an issue for these players. So there's a... Yeah, it's Tarek who has the MAC-10. So I do wonder if Hooch had a gun and where it was dropped. Nothing else being picked up by CLG so far. Gambit moving as a unit towards the A site. Going to get some smokes and Molotovs in. There's a counter flash coming in from Fugly. Gets close quarters on Dozier, but Dozier's going to shoot him straight in the face. Tarek goes down as well. So two versus three. No weapons on the remaining two CLG players. Only Hazed, who has Kevlar and a helmet. The smoke is still down towards the forklift area. MAC-10 has been picked up, but it's on JDM rather than Hazed. And there he goes. So Hayes alone will take one more with him. So good damage done to the Gambit side, but they will prove successful despite a difficult test.
Indeed. Yeah, you know, business as usual for them. And now it's going to be CLG with the full eco, more or less, going to this round. So the expectation's not really all that high. Gambit's all about keeping their economy intact and just building it. And I wonder what the setups are going to be like for CLG. Of course, JDM is going to be a real key point for me when he gets that AWP in his hands. And how Gambit will play against that, I'm sure they've done quite a large amount of research on CLG. And CLG are one of the more stable teams as well from the North American region. They've got a lot of history, a lot of demos to look at. So we could expect Gambit with some informed strategies to try to counter how CLG like to play the map.
I know, generally speaking, that Gambit have apparently been working very hard in preparation for this major. many people may have not expected them to come this far or even make it to the Major. Let's see how far they can go. Tarik with a boost, going to get down one player. Oh, they've lost two players quickly again. And this time they're going to have better weapons than before. Can CLG retrieve any? Mo can't really leave this position because he needs to hold these guns down, which means that Gambit may feel compelled to push the A site. We've got CLG set up for the retakes there, and they're falling. More people are falling here for the Gambit side. They've got two people remaining, and Waylander's only got a Tech 9. He needs to come into A main there and try and pick up one of these weapons. Nice snap by Mo, and he really needs to keep his angles open and clear out as much as possible while Waylander picks up a gun. Waylander pushing with the Tech 9, goes down. Mo with 34 HP. The bomb's down as well. He's got one more to find here. Cutler with a P250, but no armor. He's going to find the frag for his team. And Gambit, the second round was bad for them. The third round was even worse.
That's ridiculous. Oh my goodness. They really shouldn't be losing that round. CLG have so much money now, and Gambit are forced to go for a full buy. Just buy everything they possibly can. And likely that one of the better ways to play around like this is just to go with and execute, because they just won't have the firepower. You know, two Tech 9s in their hands, which means that, you know, that's pretty good at taking bomb sites, getting those two guys to run first. You gain position quickly. But they're up against AWP and full rifles and full grenades. So now Gambit have to play a really strong and fast hit here to have any chance to win this round.
Well, they're headed for the A bomb site. Dozier is going towards the squeaky door, so it seems it might be a fast A play. There are two CT players there, and one's going to get shot straight in the face. That's Tarik. Down he goes. Cutler's going to punish Adren for running through the smoke there, and Waylander will fall to Cutler as well. Fugly still holding an angle on the squeaky door. We've got pop flashes coming in from Mo, looking to go over the top, but that's going to make him susceptible to the car. Dozier, meanwhile, is being taken down, leaving Mo and Hooch. Who just got a pistol in full health. Mo's got one HP, gets a frag, falls to the flames. Hooch coming in from the connector area is, Z connector, picks up the orb. He's going to be looking towards short, or if you're from America, then it's highway. I've been playing a bit of matchmaking, learning the American phrases. He's going to reset the situation. Who knows how good Hooch is with an AWP? I certainly don't. We've got Hazed in A main, which means that Hooch can afford himself two 1v1s. But is he... Wow, Hazed. Getting taken down for free there with very poor spacing. Completely exposed to the entrance to A main. He could have easily just walked back a bit and not been exposed there. Although he had his back to the wall to get the angle he wanted, but whatever he wanted to do, it was a poor angle. Cutler coming in, but Hooch is going to go for the crouch peek, and Gambit survive.
Yeah, very, very crazy stuff there from Hooch, picking up the AWP there, and honestly, Gambit needed that desperately, and they reset CLG. CLG are going to be able to basically go for the force buy in this situation once again, because they know that Gambit's economy is very heavily strained. So if they win this round, they need to double eco anyway, and if they win this round, they can reset Gambit. So it's a very smart play. Gambit should expect a force buy in this position from CLG. So Gambit, they can't make the mistake that they made to put themselves in this position where they lost to USPs. They have to have an anti-force buy drill and not make these fundamental errors. And Dozier's already going to pick up an opening kill there, so that's going to make things a little bit easier here for Gambit, but they've got to come together at some point and trade now.
Gambit have two Molotovs in the hole. Again, this is looking at the money left on the CT side. A force buy, a full force, no quasi-buys, or whatever you want to call them. Full armor, pistols on three of the players. Tarik with the solitary M4. There are 1.5 players over towards B bomb site half, because Fugly is kind of out of the site at the moment. There is a smoke down as well. Make that three smokes, and a push coming in from the T side. Waylander leading the charge onto the site. Nobody there to trade frag for him. Hayes playing around the smoke there, and he's going to get that kill for free. Maybe he can even pick up that AK soon.
Indeed, this is going to be interesting. They're able to get players, two players onto the B bomb site, and there's a lot of opportunity for Gambit not to rush things. 50 seconds to play with, and the bomb indeed will rotate towards the A site. They won't try to force the issue onto the B site, where CLG have reinforced it with two pistolers. However, Adren will go down left for dead, and that weapon will be picked up. But as long as they get the plant on A, Gambit should be fine. But Tarik's here to save the day here for CLG. One frag might slow them down. There's the 5-7 at range from Fugly, knocking Dozier down to a mere 19 points of health. He has the AWP, and he'll miss the shot there. Long range onto the car. Fugly is going to go close with the 5-7 there, spotting that the bomb is still down. And oh, great turn there from Hayes, catching Hooch, who was on the flank. Now everything rests on Dozier's shoulders to try to save Gambit once again from a position they just frankly should never have been in the first place. And Fugly will secure it. CLG once again punishing Gambit for just not having these anti-force buy rounds down.
This is a calamitous start to the first map of this best of three. Gambit throwing opportunities away time after time after time, and they will find themselves in financial difficulty following another successful force buy from CLG here. This is just a mess, and they need to snap out of this now. You can see some frustration from the players, a bit of discussion, a lack of coordination, it seems, from the Gambit side. And here we go. In situations where you have constant trading of rounds, you often see force buy after force buy after force buy alternating between teams. And we see that now. Three smokes in mid, one A main, and one over towards B vents as well. Looks like Gambit going to split into B, having control of the B vents. Haze heavily tagged there, going for the pop flash. Hooch sees it and punishes Haze for it as well.
Here we go, JDM. Push to a defense with the AWP, misses both close range shots, and Cutler will come in from CT. The one problem for Gambit is they have no smoke grenades. Once the bomb goes down, they can't cut off these key choke points, and they've only got one significant weapon in Moe's AWP. A Dren with the flank, though, and that should be Tarik dead, and indeed, he will fall. Cutler, though, taking down Hooch towards the bomb site. And now, I believe both players should be known for Gambit. And Moe going close with the AWP, that's not going to work out for him. A Dren in a 1v2 with the bomb planted. It is at the back of the site. He hasn't got the best angle here. Takes down Cutler, but the hold was there from Fugly, and he'll be able to save the AWP as well.
That was really unfortunate for Mo. He had to make a gamble on whether they were coming higher or lower. He gambled on upper, they were both lower, so these things happen. They get the plant, that's going to help their economy.
They should force buy again. They killed four players there, they got the bomb down, and indeed, that's what they're going to go for. The pressure never ends, James. It's incessant.
Nice shot there by JDM, but the plant still came in despite his Cadillac snap stand.
Yeah, those two kills could very well have been enough, but this time it was not.
Yeah, look, despite winning the round, Tarik is reduced to a 5-7. It's been a common theme in many of these matches, actually. The economy has been strained for both teams multiple times and continues to be so. So you've got Haze boosted into the vent which allows him to look towards the mid area. That means that they can play 2B, 2A and leave one mid alone. That's going to be Cutler playing from the back, close to the short box, the sugar queue, whatever else you want to call it. And he can rotate and help A quickly as well, so they can have three people there if they need to. But looking over at mid, Hooch is going to be boosted up. This could provide opportunities later on. He could potentially go for a late flank or punish the CTs for doing so. Indeed, Cutler's running between A and mid, just keeping a glance as to what's going on. They do have a player in the vent, but he may not peek until Cutler makes the call to do so, or until he hears some firing, etc. So Gambit slowly moving towards A. Got Dozier moving closer towards the squeaky door. Squeaky door's open. Fugly's taken a lot of damage as well, down to 21 HP on the site.
Yeah, the only strange thing here is that Waylander's the only guy that doesn't have a rifle, but he has a Tech 9, and he's in the mid lurker position where you're going to be playing at ranges. And the push is going to come in onto the A site now. Can it be claimed by Gambit? This is a valiant defense so far coming in from CLG. They've taken down two players of Gambit, still preventing the bomb from going down, although there might be some space, but it's very dangerous to try to go for it, and you can see why. It won't even get planted in this position. Moe's going to fall. Tarik with a hero save. Both kills, stopping the plant, giving Haze the space to take down the last player. And that is going to be a situation now where finally Gambit they should go for a save here. I mean, they can afford to buy a few pistols due to the round loss bonus, but they shouldn't force it up now anymore.
With a player in Squeaky Door, Tarik running around like that should not happen. Mo should be protected from that angle, but he wasn't. Again, Tarik running in like Baywatch Hasselhoff with the plastic orange board thing. So, CLG.
I can't remember what
it's called. CLG go 4-3 now, and the shot is missed over towards B. However, there are not many guns here on the CT side, so one does not expect much to happen. Waylander serves himself up to the gods, and the gods will take his sacrifice and leave bones for the vultures.
This
is a good opportunity for CLG to build a bit of money, because again, the money is still piss poor for both teams at the moment. Tarik has literally nothing in the bank. Running on the fumes at the moment. There we go. Multiple digs going the way of Fugly, but they'll take that trade. 4v1, and Mo doesn't have the bomb. He will be dispatched of as well. And that gives a chance for CLG to string some rounds together. Despite all the failures of Gambit in this round so far, they have 3 of 8 rounds. And again, they have more opportunity to break CLG. Some of the ways the rounds have ended have looked awful, but there's still lots of opportunity for them to get a good half here.
Yeah, the thing is that it's always the most disconcerting when you see a team unable to In close succession, we saw two rounds failed by Gambit, whereas just an anti-force, just have a good anti-force by drill, and you win those rounds. You have a big advantage. So Gambit have to recover. They cannot have fundamental errors here. And a fast play to take control is coming in from Gambit, in towards the B side of the map. And look at the wraparound from Waylander. He's going to find three players, and that's not going to go too well for him. Hooch is there to trade one player, but still a better situation for CLG. But oh my goodness, Hooch with three, and now it's just two players left for CLG. We only have Fugly and Cutler, and they've got mid so far. One player's on B, and they have no idea where the bomb is going to end up. It can be anywhere right now.
Yeah, I don't believe they have seen the bomb at any point in this round so far. Mo's carrying the bomb, and he's walking towards A main, where Fugly's holding towards Forklift, which has paid dividends for them before when CLG have had a play in that position. And indeed, Mo is bringing the rotation towards A by smoking off the usual position. They could be walking in that smoke for all they know. Cutler's moved back towards the car now, and Dozier's going to come out and not get the shot in time, and that might ring a bell. What is the read from Cutler? He's moving towards B, but Fugly is miles away on A, so Cutler's either going to have to just wait for his rotation to come in or risk losing the round in a one versus one.
This is a tough situation indeed for the CTs, as you can see Gambit with good post-plant positions. Mo with the headshot angle there towards the upper spot where Cutler is. Looking for the shoulder peek, it's all on Cutler now. He's going to go to try to spray down Hooch. Very smart play. Hooch with four kills so far in this round. Could potentially get the ace secured here as Cutler is in the heaven area. Cutler going for the peak. It's Mo to take the shot and the round for Gambit. Hooch, man, this guy, he completely saved Gambit more than once now in spots where essentially they've been outplayed from a positional standpoint. Hooch comes in and gets the frags.
Indeed, and I was about to say Captain Cadillac was putting in work towards the B site with these first two picks that you're about to see in the replay there, but then Hooch came in, not just a cheap drink and bars in London dab, but also a man getting a 3K on the B bomb site. Very nice stuff. So CLG have gone for the force once again, force after force. This actually makes for quite fun matches, all these constant forces. Some of the players had around 6K, some didn't. So we're going to have an AWP, an M4, a Silent M4, two pistols, and a reasonable amount of nades here for CLG. So we'll see what the play is. Last round they had a strong mid take. This round they're going to have two people towards mid, I think. Actually, that's JDM in the B checkers with the AWP. We'll see how aggressive a position he chooses to take. Haze is playing from the site, which means he can throw pop flashes for JDM to peek. But in fact, JDM's going to push with the AWP, which might mean that Haze goes for a bit of a rotation. But Waylander is ready and waiting for JDM, and they'll both move away from the B bomb site.
Yeah, you can see right now there is a bit of an A play, I think, in mind for Gambit. Oh, that's a nice kill there. Dozier taking down one player away from the A bomb site. And there's a minute left to play with. Gambit is starting to set up now towards that A site. They've got Waylander who can kind of lurk in towards middle if he wants to. Although it did just get smoked off, he can push through there. And we can see a bit of a split action potentially coming in from Gambit because Adren's also there to help in middle. So Gambit looking quite dangerous at the moment. Fugly tries to take initiative and he gets shut down, leaving Cutler on 14 HP. He gets caught off over by Highway. And this is a bad look right now for CLG. Haze trying to do some damage, but it's just simply not enough. JDM left with nothing to do.
Right, so, well, nothing to do but save this AWP for the up-and-coming rounds. We know what he can do with it. I mean, going into the next round, I could get the money on CLG. It's pretty much JDM versus the rest of the world here. So it might be the case that, for example, they spend a bit of money on some flashbangs, try and pop flash him into A main to get a pick, try and rotate him if he's successful, and so on and so forth. So this AWP could be valuable, and we've seen what happens on force buys. If he gets one or two picks of it, and even if they're on an eco, maybe they win a round, who knows? We'll see if Gambit can get their act together in that respect. Waylander, who until very recently was actually in the army, left the real guns for the virtual ones, Dan.
Indeed. Nice little pop flash there from JDM to keep himself safe, and also good defense. So they'll hang on to the AWP, which in rounds like this can be very nice, as if he's able to pick up, you know, maybe they'll lose the round anyway, but it's going to give them, you know, much more chance to actually get a couple frags in. And keeping the economy down at Gambit when they're in rounds like this is going to be playing directly against the kind of situation where they should be making money. So nice that he holds on to that. He's also got loads of nades, actually. He's got a full stock of nades with that.
He has a very good spawn, actually, to jump straight into the B angle, but he's going for a more aggressive one, in fact. This is Fox-esque, but that flashbang is going to be a bit of a pain. He's got support from some teammates, but it may just be the vultures waiting to pick the AWP from his warm body should he be unsuccessful. That is a great start, but now the question is he going to rotate like he needs to? Indeed, he's running away from B, because you in this situation, you're going to expect Gambit to move away from the saved weapon, so JDM is running all the way to A, but Gambit might have a read on this, because they've got Hooch moving into the vents from mid, and the bomb is coming mid, so it seems they might just funnel a bit of a conga line into the B bomb site.
Yeah, and you can see smartly, Hayes is just going to take a good position instead of trying to get the gun and then be potentially out of position. And that might get him the kill. Oh, he gets a few three shots on the Dren, but cannot finish him off. That's a really unfortunate situation there. But in comes Cutler, almost getting a really nice timing on the player throwing the grenade, but he's going to have to back away. And this is good now from Gambit. They're actually able to coordinate onto the B site altogether, and they're not hemorrhaging any players before doing so, as in previous rounds. Hooch is there to defend Ben as well. So it all looks well now in the camp of Gambit. JDM does get a bit of a tag there, but finally gets eliminated.
I'd say both teams made the right decision in that situation. JDM rotating the AWP, but Gambit making the right read. He's probably going to rotate the AWP, so yep. let's just go to B. Nicely done. Maybe JDM should have tried to go for the save again at the end there, because there wasn't much he could do. There were four people alive when he's trying to get his AWP game on. But there we go. It will be lost, and he will be reduced from the AWP to a FAMAS. He did well to save it for one round at least. So Gambit building a nice lead now. Well, a nice score. It's only one round lead, but it's a nice score. Six rounds from 11 on the T side. Could have been more, but they'll take that. You can see CLG back on the buy, but they are limited in grenades already. Only two smokes in the hole with what they've put down.
Yeah, you can see they're really cutting every corner. No one has a helmet, which is sad times in war. But Tarik will be pushed over the boost. And Adren, not quite expected the right angle, and Tarik with a quick frag and falls back now. This is good, just falling back to safety, more passive positions. Now you've got the man advantage. And they force Gambit now to respond with something. And Gambit are deciding to move towards the A main area at the moment. You see Mo is looking for the initial entry, perhaps, if there was to be a player close, but looks to be not the case so far. And CLG, they don't have much information, but that's okay considering that they already have a man advantage.
So Mo's got an angle onto A with the AWP, but Fugly, you can see he's playing a nice angle where he was just jump peeking from the quad boxes, and Tarik has been sacrificed, but will sacrifice pay off for CLG? They've only got two players on the site at the moment, and there are four Gambit players about to charge, but they're a bit hesitant at the moment. That's allowing more CTs to rotate. Now we've got Haze towards Car, Fugly holding things down for the time being. Nice counter flash from, I think that was Fugly from the Car as well, and that's going to give Fugly on the site, sorry, more time to find more frags. So he gets one through the door. Now it's just down to the man, Fugly, who was on quads, and Gambit will take the round. Sorry, it was I think it was Hayes coming towards the car position, but Gambit's hesitation to take the site allowed him to get that counter flash in, which did more damage to their side. Nevertheless, they take the round and extend their lead to two, and Counter Logic Gaming are poor once again.
Yeah, we've had a lot of really scrappy rounds, but despite that, Gambit are doing really well now. They've got themselves seven on the board against the five of CLG. So if they can continue this, and you know, definitely their favorite to do so, considering that now CLG, what have they got to play with? They've got just some 5-7 and P250s and only two armors. So CLG not with the strongest of buys, to say the least, bit of a quasi.
CLG have been doing awful in the ESCA League, actually. Recently. So Gambit with seven rounds on the board already on the T side, you probably have to be concerned if you're a CLG player, but just purely because of their recent form. There we go. Tarik's going to get shot straight in the face. Hooch is moving into the mid area. We have people rotating out of the B bomb site, but Gambit aren't committing to anything just yet. 5v4. They know CLG are on the eco. Hopefully they've learned their lesson from the anti-force, anti-eco buys, which have failed repeatedly in this first game already.
Absolutely. I mean, that was a very, very bad sign, but at least, you know, now they're starting to get things together again. But they still are making some of the same mistakes, isolating more players than they need to. That said, they're picking up the kills. So at the end of the day, that's all you really need to be doing. And now, after the initial trades in the rounds, it's all about that A hit. In fact, they're splitting onto A from middle as well. So just Fugly left now, and it's like they're going to claim that 8th round without too much issue. No one going down for Gambit Gaming, and CLG now in a position where they don't have enough rounds, I think, so far. They really need to get the last two to be feeling at any, you know, at all confident.
Yeah, this score, they don't want, they're not going to be happy with, well, for them, the score should be the other way around, basically.
Absolutely, yeah.
They don't want Gambit getting more than five rounds on Gambit's T side, and Gambit have the opportunity to double the score that they would ideally have if you were a CT right now. So JDM is back on AWP, and he's in fact rotating his position away from B towards quad on A, so we'll see if that takes Gambit by surprise, if they can capitalize on that. We've got Hayes playing alone on the B bomb site now, and Tarek's playing close mid, with Cutler playing at the back.
Yeah, it would be quite interesting to see if Gambit are going to start experimenting with something like a delayed mid attack in this round, because CLG are in a spot where they might feel like taking a risk could be a good option. So by playing slow in the start of the round, you kind of make it the percentages, you know, go less in the favor of the opposition, that they're going to catch you out of position because you're kind of expecting it. Then you can hit them when they're kind of rotating later into the round with a delayed mid take, and then build the A or the B play off of the frags you get there. And Gambit actually going to be tossing in some nades here from behind A main into the A bomb site.
Yeah, so you saw Regen throw a Molotov into the vent, which might suggest a B split, actually. But, well, here comes the mid-take, 50 seconds on the clock. Dozy is going to fly and take Tarek down as Regen moves into mid. Hayes holding an angle onto B, so it is going to be B after all, but it's a three-man rotation here from CLG, and Hayes can't hold down the vent, which means the B site is open, and Fuckley's going to have to fight for it. That smoke might allow him to get into the headshot position. He's going to try, and indeed he is successful, which means there's another retake that needs to happen here for the T site. 30 seconds left, Mo takes on Fuckley, leaving JDM alone. Gets a nice snap onto Hooch. That's the bomb down on the site itself. He might rotate his position. There's a flank coming in, though, from Adren.
Yeah, this flank from Adren is very, very key. Makes life a little bit easier. Smoking off JDM. Will he look behind himself? Oh, there's a gap there. That's going to really tease JDM. And JDM's going to try to use that to actually look through and grab the attention there. Can Adren come in with the flank? He's going to go over the top, actually. And he's spamming a bit through the smoke here. JDM might get this frag if only Adren had actually really given his position away. But he's just going to stop firing and fall back now. Gambit playing this one incredibly safe. And Adren taking a good post-plant position. JDM will try to smoke his way out and flash his way out now, as that bomb ticks away. Both players very low, but so is, well, JDM and Adren both very low. But Waylander's quite healthy. Mo's quite healthy, rather. And here he goes, up onto the site now, and Adren's going to catch him. Gambit playing that really safe, and looks like CLG are in a lot of trouble now, as Gambit go 9 rounds.
You can see how dangerous JDM is when he put that smoke down. That peak he did, even though nobody was there, was so fast. Let's have a look at what Mo's up to here. Nice shot there. Does he get the second one to Fugly? Indeed, he does. Very good stuff. So Gambit with 9. You have to favor them for the map now, really, surely.
Yeah, I mean, it's really nice in their position when they can rely on such a standard strategy. The slow play into delayed mid-take, get the kill on vent into a fast B hit. That's such a standard kind of way to play the map. And if it works like that, it's pretty sick, actually, for them. And CLG now scrambling. Lack of grenades, lack of firepower. Gambit could just run the same strategy if they really wanted to. Got a bit of a stack actually from CLG towards the A site. So they might try to actually pop flash into A main here and try to take some map control and see if they can try to level the disadvantage by taking map control away from the opponents. And it might work out here. Can they get the frag on Adren? Trade perhaps? Yes, there it is. Key information and a key frag.
But he cannot retrieve the gun. Throws a Molotov and then moves away from A main. Mo's got to be careful because he's carrying the gun. Dozier finally gets taken down towards Squeaky, being quite a nuisance to CLG in that position. And that means with 2 men down, Gambit are going to have to move away from protecting that gun. And they've got to concentrate towards the B bombsite where they have, again, JDM in isolation. He only got a FAMAS this time. No fancy kills for him. Mo takes him down with his favorite weapon, down to a 3v3 now. So Gambit needs to get the plant down, but they've got to be wary of upper and lower CT side, vents and T, so they don't have enough personnel to cover all the angles.
Yeah, it's going to be a tough one. A lot of it's going to come down to what Hooch is able to accomplish in the vents for the defense of Gambit, as the two players outside of the vents, which is currently smoked off, Hooch on max health as well. Oh, good, solid damage there from Hooch onto Tarek. He's getting spammed down a little bit now. He's going to get eliminated. No frags actually from him, so more pressure onto Mo, but Mo has got the shot. Tarek is out of the picture. Oh, great second kill coming in from Mo. That should really silence the efforts here. But Cutler, he's going for it right now. Mo missing a shot. Can Cutler get this done? Jumping in with a pistol. It's on Mo, and he's going to deliver for Gambit. 10-5 first half on the T side. That is a great way to end this first half, considering how shaky Gambit looked at the start.
Gambit just got 7 rounds in a row on their T side. And to be honest with you, if they didn't screw up so many rounds at the beginning, then that could have been like a 14-1.
Oh yeah. And Mo is a really big part of that. He's got 21 kills, actually. He's doing a great job so far. And one of the things, too, for CLG, because the economy was always in dire straits, we never really saw JDM in a position where he could really get to use that AWP of his, because that's what's really dangerous, is JDM's AWP on the team.
I know, but like, I was actually looking forward to seeing Mo in this tournament because he is such an explosive AWPer. And I think it might be Nyanko I was talking to who said, you know, he is a good AWPer, but he doesn't perform as well versus tier one teams. Obviously, CLG, you couldn't say right now, are a tier one team, but you can see his effect having 21 kills in one half. And again, yeah. Really, Gambit could have had a 14-1 half there were it not for just having, like, apparently no proper anti-force buy strats. No Molotovs, haven't learned anything from threat.
I mean, there was another situation, for example, where JDM was able to save an AWP and the rest of his teammates couldn't buy, so they kind of saved behind it, and they played into B storage. Now, that's quite a cool idea, because you're going to try to focus away, you know, one player potentially, because if, you know, in normal defaults, you're going to have maybe, you know, players around boost, maybe like one around Squeaky Door or main, and one on B storage. So you can maybe isolate one player and take him down with the numbers. And the thing is that when you know that they're in a situation where they're on eco, you shouldn't be able to get isolated, basically. You shouldn't be playing like defaults versus what you expect to be weapons, because they're expecting pistols. So they actually made life really difficult for themselves. Again, it really feels like they're not cognizant enough of these, of when their opponents have just pistols.
Yeah. And if Gambit proves successful in this best of three, then those mistakes are going to be punished more and more by stronger and stronger teams, to the point where they could lose the match because of making those mistakes.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
Exactly,
yeah.
So we're about to get into the second half. Obviously, Gambit going to be on the CT side. Let's see how they approach the A side. You can see it often varies. Quite often you have the retakes there and what CLG have to offer on their T pistol.
I hope it's good, James, for their sake. I hope it's good.
Indeed it is. So having a look at the initial T aggression, they seem to be concentrated towards the A bomb site. Bombs left in T warehouse for the time being. Dozier's going for a straight peek towards A main, and he's going to find Fugly there, but Fugly's going to back off, and Dozier's just going to hold an angle, which is information for his team. But he's got nobody watching his six. You see, Tarek was towards Squeaky, but he's running away now, and Dozier's moved to a more passive position. While Gravity brings CLG down towards B. Adren getting boosted up, though. Tarek has left the building. JDM holding an angle towards mid. He's going to get wrecked as well. Clutch King of 100 ping with two frags.
Yeah, but it looks like the B bomb site is going to go to CLG. So despite being a man down, they're going to have a solid chance into this one. Now you can see that Gambit are really just taking their time, setting up around all the entry points to the bomb site. Higher CT, vents, B storage, they're going to have a man in every single angle. So that's going to be good, and they're going to coordinate and go in promptly. Here it is, Adren, the first man to distract the vent player. Perfectly done. Now Mo has an opportunity to get out of there, and he's going to try. Nice snap there from Hazed. And in comes Hooch. Hazed with a frag on him as well. And now it's just down to Fugly versus Adren. Adren already with four kills. Can he make it? The ace against Fugly. He's trying, and he will. Adren with the ace.
Got no kit.
But no kit indeed. Will he be able to make it in time?
Oh,
it looks like
too
he can't.
Far away.
Oh, unfortunate. That was close.
He's the hero we deserve, Dan, but not the hero we needed. CLG, take the pistol.
At least he got five kills. That's he can have. He's gonna have a lot of money now, despite them losing the round. He's got $3,000. I wonder if he'll buy. What he'll buy with that?
Gambit was super unlucky there. They had a 4-2 situation, but there were some nice headshots coming out of the checkers area. It was very good timing as well. People reloading couldn't answer. But there we go. CLG with a fighting chance. If they lost that pistol, then I don't know.
Yeah, it's actually really interesting because Adren got the ace. He's got a Famas. He's got the kit that he picked up, the Kevlar and three nades. That's actually quite legit. But I have to see if that was going to turn into anything. A lot of dangerous pistols. Three Deeks as well.
Deeks.
CLG, they have to respect this. They need to have a good anti-force buy round of their own.
That is a terrible smoke in A main. I mean, that is so bad that the T's can almost walk through it into the boost position. Shoddy performance there.
You triggered, James.
Slightly. Being a nade nerd, I'm slightly triggered then. Tarek's moving towards the squeaky door. You can see JDM still holding a passive angle behind the box, which will, for the most part, only reveal his head. Got a bit of a spray going down. Ooh, I think we might have a flash attempt there. I think the CT's tried to flash through the door and it just completely failed and flashed Dozier behind the door instead. So we've got three CTs over towards the A site. and three T's over there. Cutler is holding almost from CT spawn.
Yeah, I like that. That's much
from T spawn, excuse me. It can actually be fun to stand on the road sign at T spawn with a scout and just pick people off.
Here we go.
Who tried to push, such as Waylander.
This is what we wanted to see. So an actual some strats here with these nades, but getting picked off with a boost there from Adren, looking a little bit awkward, but they are going to be able to get themselves in the site, and they've got the rifles, so quite a strong result so far. But who's actually getting in there? Dozier now able to take down Tarik, he had no idea, and also almost getting the kill onto Hazed. Dozier causing real issues now. Cutler coming in, he was essentially the lurker of the team in the outmost position, but now he's going to save the day. But what is this? Waylander with the headshot on the Deagle onto Cutler, and once again, James, it's happening. CLG had a way better approach that round, but they didn't. They just got caught off.
Molotovs, Dan.
Yeah.
You know what's really cool? But Molotovs, Dan.
But they were trying to throw the Molotovs. But the problem is that they didn't. They weren't trying to do it behind smoke, which is if you know how to do it behind the smoke, that's the key. That's the best way to do it, because then you can't get picked off as you're throwing the nades. but yeah, 6-11.
The window of opportunity has been swiftly shut. You know that GIF where like these CIS CTs are like just foot dive? They get a Dr. Doom foot dive through a car window. That's what Gambit just did to CLG there. They got the foot dive through the window, and now CLG have all the pressure in the world. Oh. Like they are many leagues under the sea. Oh, this nade could be money from Dozier, but he chooses not to throw it just yet. Oh, it's going to be delayed. Is that going to be NBA? No, but Waylander's going to take down Fugly in the meantime. So CLG have an opportunity to plant a bomb. Nice spray from Dozier, which is going to cause problems. Hayes has the bomb, though, and he is on the site, moving towards default now. And indeed, the bomb plant's going to go down. 5-3 retake, but there's money is in the bag here for CLG. But can they take the round as well?
Yeah, there's not many nades left on Gambit, and the players are very nadeable at the moment. Going to go close with the rifles instead. And just a couple players left here getting cleaned up. What an onslaught there from Gambit, just getting in there, straight in there, no messing around.
All the way in.
And that's the defuse. So Gambit going 12-6 now. And, well, CLG, they do get the bomb down at least.
Their money's still...
No frags, unfortunately, for them.
Yeah, they are still poverty, though. I don't know if they can really buy in this round, or if they do, it's gonna suck, Dan. They have half the score of Gambit at the moment, but Gambit aren't too close to that 16 just yet. But really, if CLG don't win the following round, then we are looking at a 0-1 to Gambit.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm curious what CLG will do this time around, because so far we can't see really any grenades from them. So
and smoke and a flash, Dan.
Yeah, that's, I guess...
Again, with a smoke and a flash...
Pop flash and smoke for short, for highway.
I mean, exactly. I mean, you can do a certain short plant if you put that smoke down for highway, if you know it, and pop flash through a main and then hope for the best.
I think he's going to try to flash MBK or something. Because it's three players door, so there's the smoke for highway.
But look at let's note what Gambit are doing here. They know that there might be some shenanigans, and they seem to be quite happy to play a retake situation here. Let the plant go down and have that 13th round.
They do have a lot of grenades, so this is going to be really hard for CLG to survive against all the incendiaries. And well, that's it. There's only one left.
Adren trying to play the piano on CLG head, but not getting the connection just yet. The MP9 coming in up close. The 5-7 to follow up. JDM. Not going to get taken down. We've got a team kill, NBA, but it's the wrong Hoop, Dan.
Oh my god. Waylander and Dozier to kill Hooch. That's an assist on your teammate. Brilliant. Well, at least they get the round, James, and the previous one was they did survive with five players. So, you know, it's not the end of the world. Their money's still in good shape. So, insta purchase of the AWP onto Mo. And Dren's still sitting there with 7.4k deciding what to do with it. And CLG lots of money too, getting the bomb down. So now this is where, you know, the comeback, if it's going to happen for CLG, it's really got to start now. Because if they don't win the round, bomb needs to go down so they can fall by next round, and they need to get a lot of frags.
Look how far back that chair is. I mean, he could fall into the red windows behind him.
I know. I was quite surprised because, yeah, his setup is quite strange, actually, to me.
It's super cool, though. Look at him. He's a swag lord in his imaginary Cadillac, just cruising down I-95.
Taking a tactical timeout here.
CLG, only Fugly has bought on CLG so far, so they are literally discussing everything about their plan. Look, guys.
The thing is, though, in spots like this is the classic thing, right, where, you know, Gambit obviously get to kind of benefit as well from this timeout, because they can say, all right, guys, you know, what do we want to do? Can talk a little bit about that. But mostly they're going to think, okay, what do we think CLG is going to do? And what is the best way for us to blow that up before they can do it? So you know, usually teams will try to take a bit of map control somewhere. So you'll try to maybe have like three players instead of you know, pressuring mid or something as you might do normally, you take them to B storage, take away B storage, hold one guy in toxic, then send the rest away. Or maybe you do the other way around, take a couple players into A main, take that away. And then if, you know, CLG expected to build a play from that, they don't get to do it. So, you know, I'm curious how, what Gambit's interpretation will be.
Indeed. Well, Gambit, they have a fair amount of money in the bank. We've got Waylander on FAMAS, but he's got 6.5K in the hole. So even if things go wrong here for Gambit, it's going to be a while before CLG break them. And CLG must be feeling all the pressure here because, you know, Gambit are a team that surely they can't be too familiar with. I mean, Gambit's a reasonably new lineup. We have some exiled players from Hellraisers being Dozier and Adren, obviously. But there's not much history to Gambit itself with regards to their current CSGO team. Mm. So in terms of research, in terms of having a coach and so on, can they even anti-strat Gambit? I feel like they just have to take reads within games and try and figure something out here.
Right. And play off the player's confidence as well. I mean, it could very well be that, you know, JDM's in a situation where he's thinking, all right, guys, you know, leave it to me. Give me the space at the start of the round to open something up, and then we'll make the mid-round call off of what happens then. And then, you know, if I can't get anything, we can do this. And that could be an the idea too. Or they could say, let's go for a delay mid-take, and then they could have a play they want to make off of that. We'll have to see how things build based on what's going on now. So bomb has been dropped outside of T Warehouse, so pretty standard stuff there. Got JDM looking for the opener towards B storage, and he's going to get it. So now, 5v4 early in the round. This is where CLG can really start to take control of the map.
Yeah, so the question is, are there two people over towards B? Are there one? Is it going to be a rotation? CLG are just going to sit on their pick. They've got a minute 20 on the clock, loads of time. So they're not going to do anything crazy. Bomb's still in T Warehouse, and Haze is holding very passively, just in case there's a push coming in through that smoke. Adren's alone in mid, and mid is vulnerable because he doesn't really have any help over there. He doesn't want to play close. Look at the amount of nades on CLG as well. They can do executes, they can do whatever they want. They can go for a slow mid take with these Molotovs, put them under boost, put them in the vent, etc. They can suggest that they're going towards B with a Molotov into the vent. They can do whatever they want, and you can see those nades start to come out, and here comes the mid take, which will allow them to split a site, but Adren is going to stop color in his tracks, which will be a problem.
Yeah, and it's always really nice getting this mid take in at this point, because usually when you take one player away, mid is the first thing that's going to be weak. And that's what they've got now. So Hayes is going to be re-smoking CT connector, and his teammates slowly making the play in towards B. And Gambit don't know what's going on just yet, because they don't have any info. They need info in A main, but they're not getting it. So now they're just going to have to wait until the push hits them on B, and the rotation only now is happening. If CLG are fast with the frags here, it's going to be pretty good for them. Fugly opens up onto Hooch. So now Gambit is in kind of a rough spot because the bomb is about to be planted, and vent room and B storage is under control of CLG now. So this is still in CLG's hands.
Adren knows his angles, but it doesn't manage to get enough of a connection. Fugly is holding an angle for Dozier, and he will be primed and ready now because of Dozier's nades. Oh, Dozier's got to be careful here. It's only 6 HP, but Dozier will brazenly drop the flashbang in there, flash himself at the same time because it hit the rim, as you can see there. So he's causing himself problems. Meanwhile, Adren's going down, taken by Haze, so it's a 4v2. So what is the play from Gambit? Looking at the CT money, they will be able to buy in the next round, but I wouldn't say they can afford to just try and kill as many people as possible, because if their economy gets broken, then CLG could quickly catch up to their score. So they will go for the save, but take any opportunities that come their way, and they won't come their way, and so CLG back to winning ways.
The big problem there is that when you lose middle like that, in a situation like that, you have to do something. You have to get some information, and the information, if you lose middle, you can't get it from middle, so it's B storage or A, and A was the easiest option for them. And if obviously it's a process of elimination, if you see no one at that point when the team has to be doing something because it's quite late into the round, then they can rotate much earlier, about 5 to 10 seconds earlier. Maybe not 10 seconds, but 5 seconds earlier, and then they have players in position in time. That was Gambit winning. CLG winning purely because they just outpaced the rotation.
So Gambit still sticking with their CT default, 2 mid, 2 B, and Dozier alone towards A. There are actually two people in squeaky here for the T side, and Fugly is holding the box in A main, which would suggest they are either looking for a pick with a lot of pressure towards A, or they're just going to go there regardless. They've got Lurker towards B, which is Cutler. Again, two people in squeaky door, and there it is. JDM going to find the shot onto Adren, punished for looking for information. And Dozier will see one player move away from that Molotov. But again, CLG have an early pick with over a minute on the clock. Can they capitalize on this again?
Yeah, I mean, they still have Cutler, who's pretty defensive in B storage. And the team, it really feels like CLG are ready for this A hit, and indeed they're pushing their way in. Fugly over the top of the forklift will get killed by Dozier. He didn't have the support on this going into that push. And now things get a little bit awkward because Bomber's going to be rotating back because it couldn't get into the A site. And Gambit have a player close. It's Hooch. He's going to hear the running. Hooch has got all the info right now for his team. The rotation's starting to happen. Gambit are in a good position. If Waylander can hold, we'll get a couple kills. Great position. Hooch will help him out. And that is Tarik out of the picture. Waylander still dancing around the smoke. And all the frags going the way of Gambit. Coming in from the back. And now it's just going to be JDM by the vent position. And he's got the AWP, so this is pretty hard. But if Hooch is not going to be looking, maybe JDM has an in here. Oh, what a shot coming in from JDM. Two players still left to go with 20 seconds on the clock. The bomb is in no man's land, straight in the middle. And JDM's down to 3 points of health. So his chances are now slim to none. With 10 seconds left, has to pick up both frags. Another kill coming in. JDM can't win the round, but he sure as hell goes out with a bang.
Disaster indeed strikes here for CLG. That's a round they could not afford to lose, literally. Their money averages from 3 to 5k, and it seems the force is coming out. Tarik had the least money, and he's gone for the buy. Fugly picking up an AK. Great work by JDM. He had no choice but to go for that because of the implications of losing the round. The round was lost regardless, but if they can get a bit fortunate here, considering their lack of utility, then they will indeed break the CT economy now. So fingers crossed that they can stay in this game and take it a bit longer. We'll see if they manage to do that. We've got four players of CLG with their limited weapons moving towards B, so it seems they're going to go for the bum rush. But again, we've got Waylander and Hooch here, and Hooch is in a position where he can flashbang for his teammate, but Waylander's playing that kind of one and done, but the smoke may allow him to live a bit longer. Hooch will run distraction. Hazo, 180 no scope, straight into Waylander's face. Down goes Hooch as well. So it's a 3 versus 4. CLG have the sight. Adren can't stop them from crossing, and the bomb will go down.
Yeah, this is once again, another tough retake situation, but Gambit, lots of time to play with. And their money, though, is not very good. They're probably going to consider the save here, to be honest, because their money sucks. And, of course, I would be reset as well, having just one around. So Gambit will actually retreat with the three weapons. And they will, you know, if they can keep all three members alive, they can very easily just drop for teammates.
Mo's going to be $100 short of dropping an M4, but he can obviously drop a FAMAS. And then who knows what happens to the rest. Maybe Hooch can drop a Mag 7 or a UMP, as we've seen them arise so commonly in this tournament so far. So CLG on death's door in game one managed to close it again for the time being. Sixth round deficit now, surviving with four players will be crucial for their economy going forward. And we'll see what kind of buy the Gambit players can muster.
In seven rounds, Mo's picked up, I think, what was it, 21 frags, I think, that he had in the first half. So he's only picked up 5 in 7 rounds, which is not too bad, I guess. But he's definitely calmed down a little bit. Now we're going to have to see what can be brought to the table here. Hooch is on a 5-7, rest of his teammates on rifles. Mo's still with that AWP, and decent amount of nades, generally speaking. Mo is there's been a little bit of pressure initially into the middle area before falling back towards the quad on A, and CLG with a lot of presence, 3 men in A main.
Indeed, but there was a bit of running there, which Dozier will hear, which is why Mo has rotated to that position, and we know how capable he is. But with everything slowing down, they'll not really know what CLG are planning. And again, they're not really going for any aggression at the moment. Two players are in mid for the CTs, though. And again, you see Mo start to spam. Tarik got shot to about 14 HP because of Mo spam last time, and he's going to have to be careful on this occasion. Flashes, counter flashes coming in. So the T push that may have been attempted is not going to be successful just yet. Oh, Mo just shooting between two players there as T start to encroach on the site. Hooch and Mo go down. Fugly is around default. There is a player still on the site on the other side of red, and that's Dozier, but he gets shot straight through the smoke by JDM. 4 versus 2 now for the T's. This is the opportunity they needed. Great flashes coming in. Everybody blind, but Dren goes down. Waylander is going hell for leather, but it's not going to be enough. CLG with momentum now have broken the CT economy.
Yeah, this is a really big problem. Gambit probably going for a full save, but also a timeout as well, just to be safe. And hey, you get a timeout per map, so this is a great time to use it. They only need 2 more rounds. They've just they're in a spot where they basically will full eco, and then they'll be on $2,400. So everyone will have around 5,400 to 5,800-ish. So they're gonna have a really healthy buy, but they want to decide in advance what to do with it. So Gambit, I've got to say, been looking generally quite decent, a little bit better than I expected. And CLG starting to find a way back in. I wonder how long their momentum is going to last here.
This is the point. This is the point where you start to get worried if you're a Gambit fan, because we've seen time and time again with a lot of CIS teams recently that sometimes. More than that.
Because
often you see them in situations where they should close things out, Gambit here being in 14-9, but they don't manage to do it. If you remember Hellraisers at the major qualifier, they had many good opportunities. That was one of the most brutal things I've watched. And that's been their story time and time and time again, just haven't got things over the line. They're apparently actually announcing roster changes today. I don't know if it's happened yet or not, but look out for that on the internets. But, you know, and again, the flip side, five overtimes. They should win. They're a better team on that map. Unable to do it. And now we have Gambit here, five-round deficit. But obviously, two of these plays used to be on Hellraisers. They've been in many situations before where they've been unable to close things out. You have to wonder if that starts to creep into the back of their minds, or if they've played the game for so long, they're veterans that they don't think about that kind of thing. But I certainly do as a viewer, because again, Hellraiser flip side, you see it too many times. So you have to wonder if that's about to happen here. But CLG, you have to wonder where their heads are at. The best of ones have gone for the time being, so you know they're not going to be too worried at the moment, but they're going to feel like they're a better team. They have more experience, they've been together longer, they have a team house, etc. They should be winning this, but they have a huge deficit. They are clawing things back, they've broken the economy, but there's going to be a buy coming from the CTs in the next round, and they'll still be four rounds behind.
Yeah, I think to me as well, you know, CLG tend to be pretty good in the kind of high pressure situations. From what I've seen, they're, you know, relatively consistent in those spots. Obviously, this, I mean, Gambit should never really throw this one away. Just two more rounds and they're pretty much done and dusted. And they've got a lot of... the thing is that they haven't been that aggressive in a lot of spots. So I think they've been a bit too hesitant and not really taken the fight to CLG. And I think this has given CLG the in back into the game, because Gambit gives so much up, allowing CLG to pretty much build rounds and however they want.
Dictate the pace.
Exactly. And, you know, whilst it is risky business as a CT side, you've got to have that in your repertoire against a decent T side.
So this is a pretty solid eco here from the CTs. We have two pistols purchased and a flashbang onto Dozier. I'm going to have a quick look and see where Dozier is. He's over towards the A site. But it might be a counter flash should a push come in, because they've got a player up high and another player on the A site as well. CLG slowly creeping. But they've got five Molotovs and there's no Molotov in Hoochie's position. That is really poor. They've got a man standing behind them as well. How does that call not even come in? I don't care that they got a kill there. There should always be a Molotov going down in the sandbag area. They know this.
Yeah, absolutely. It's pretty unforgivable, to be honest. I mean, the thing is that there's so many danger spots, and with five Molotovs, you can easily just clear a path, especially on either the B site or the A site. You can Molotov basically everything. You can always find a way to get into a safe position.
Why has he bought it? Like, I honestly don't care that none of them have died. Why have they all bought Molotovs if they're not going to use them on an anti-eco?
I don't know, James.
You can't make these mistakes.
This is basic, Dan.
This is basic. It's like putting shoes on.
This is triggering me all last year. I'm hoping that it's going to get better.
But we've seen this. We've, like, in our Face It Leagues in North America, we've seen this forever. If there's ever a time to not make sloppy mistakes like that, it's the Major. You can see it there. He has a 180 and he's left with 8 HP. That's terrible.
All right, let's move on past this and hope to see better things in that regard. Gambit, they've got full rifle set up. The thing is, they are lacking grenades, heavily so. And CLG, I mean, once again, let's see how much space they're kind of given for free. You can see in this situation, most playing incredibly tentatively in middle. There's no presence from Gambit in middle. If CLG wanted to take it, they could, but they're actually going to try to fake out A, throwing loads of smoke grenades there. The rotation is happening. Hooch is rotating away from B towards A as the bomb has been picked up by Fugly, and they make the play into B now. And will Gambit realize in time? They're starting to run back to B. They might actually just make it in time. We'll have to see how the nades go, but here comes the spray coming in from Hooch. He's able to take down Haste, and he might just have done enough damage here. Fugly responds onto Mo, but Waylander's still on the site, and this is a big deal.
And they still haven't rotated the CTs. Adren is still in mid. Dozier's just moving away from A now, but Gambit are still in control of the B bomb site with Waylander on the site. So it's really awkward for both teams. They've got JDM in the checkers, but Cutler is in mid, so he might be trying to get a cheap kill going for a flank, but there's nobody mid. Adren's still all the way in A. So JDM needs to find a frag, and indeed he does. Waylander takes it all in the face here. We've got flashbangs coming into lower, but there's no smoke there, which means Hooch can still cover the cross. He doesn't want to peek, but he's going to do it to get the information. The information is received straight in the chest, and now the advantage is back in the hands of CLG. 30 seconds left. Dozy's got the high ground. JDM is creeping in the site as well. Flashbangs coming in. Not sure if Dozer can get a frag in this situation. Adrenna's only now rotating from the A site. Flying down is not going to be enough for Dozier. JDM's going to dispatch of him as well. That could have gone either way, but CLG held and Gambit walks into the trap.
It's kind of questionable as well to see Dozier dropping into the site there, because there's two players left and he's completely alone. There's no support for him. So basically, CLG would have to make a massive mistake there for Dozier to get more than a single kill. And then Adren's still in a really difficult spot. Adren's actually going to go for it. My goodness, he gets both kills. This is unbelievable. All of a sudden, Cutler's like, what the hell is going on? He's sprinting back to try to cover the bomb in time. There goes the flash. Oh, Cutler gets it just in the nick of time. That was a scary situation. But yeah, I was going to say, I mean, it should only be a huge mistake from CLG to have that round lost. And Gambit, of course, we can see now, losing that round, they have no money. All right.
What is their loss bonus? They have lost four rounds in a row, which means they're going to have a huge buy in the next round. But again, ooh, we're starting to see Deagles coming. They're spending a bit more because they know they're going to get a bit more in the next round should they lose this one. But let's see if CLG are going to be as sloppy as they were on their last anti.
I mean, I really need to see Gambit putting more pressure into mid, more players into middle as well. They're giving up so much of the map. And okay, here it is. Is there sloppiness? We've got two frags going the way of CLG. They're just battling into that mid area. Adrenna's found himself into the T warehouse. But unfortunately for him, there's nobody there to kill. And CLG are just wrapping onto the A bomb site. So it should be pretty clean from this point forward for CLG. I'll have to see. But yeah, you know, going into the next round, Gambit might be able to keep this AK alive as well. But the thing is, as you say, you know, they'll have loads of cash anyway, so it doesn't actually matter.
To add to the issue on their last anti-eco, I don't know if it, I think it was Hazed who was in the middle. But the thing is, if I'm not mistaken, he was in the middle on his own. Like, you can have somebody boosted, throw a Molotov so you can still keep your gun out, because you don't want to be standing in the mid on your own with a nade in your hand.
Mm.
Get a boost in there, get a Molotov down, and then get off the boost and go back into A main if you want to do that. But there we go. That's what I always wonder. People say, oh, you know, worked really hard in this major. We studied really hard, but you can't Molotov sandbags. So the gap's going to be closed to two.
Indeed. I'm really worried for Gambit at the moment, to be honest. CLG are basically just having their way with the map every single time, with no pressure anywhere. So let's see what Gambit's variation now. They have all the money, all the nades, all the weapons. How are they going to set up as a CT side here? Because, again, if you look at the cash of CLG, it's so massive right now, which means that Gambit just haven't been getting the kills, and the bomb has just been going down with ease.
Indeed. So I think CLG have realized that if they can draw a player away from the B bomb site, it's quite susceptible to them taking it, and it's really hard for Gambit to retake. They've had success there. Again, they're going to have Cutler holding there passively as a lurker. So they're going to go for their basically default. We've got Tarik going towards Squeaky, but they know that there's going to be a big buy. Ooh, so much damage done to Waylander there.
Yep.
That's going to be a problem going forward. Tarik's being more passive towards Squeaky, perhaps because he's scared of the Mo AWP spam. Starting to come in now and harass a little bit. But Mo's actually holding the AWP in mid at the moment. And Waylander, with all the damage he's taken, is stuck to checkers where he can often find, well, could often find Kishima, for example, behind the box. But with all the Molotovs on the CLG side, if they go towards B, one would hope a Molotov would go down in that direction.
And, you know, once again, Gambit are playing insanely passive. And they've basically been doing that more or less every single round that they've had guns. And Mo now has rotated out of mid, so no eyes directly on middle, and it's going to be three players on the A bomb site. But CLG, after his initial presence there, are backing away towards B. This is like actually a really sick way to play this round, because obviously, as we can see, in the tendency of Gambit has been to do stuff like this. They don't have any information. They need to pop flash into somewhere to get info. I think they're doing so into A main, so they have the info.
Someone needs to realize this on Gambit, because it happens time and time and time again. Adren goes down on A, but Dozier is still going to rotate towards mid slash B, where the bomb is. Again, Tarik's still trying to just run distraction. Dozier's in mid, but 20 seconds left. Have CLG left this too long? They need to breach the site. They're starting to put some smokes down towards headshot. But there's 14 seconds now, and they need to take the site. But Hooch, ooh, I was going to say he's going to give himself up for the taking, but I think CLG have made a mistake here. They've got 7 seconds left for him to plant the bomb. 5, 4. It's too late now. They've lost the round.
This is so strange as well. My goodness. And also, you know, Waylander's still behind the envious box. I don't know if anyone calls it that, but I call it the envious or happy box. You know, at the back of the event room. the checkers room. Like, he's just sitting there as well on like 10 HP as well. I mean, they left themselves no time to do anything there on the bomb site, let alone the surrounding areas.
So again, like the last few rounds, CLG have won like, all right, let's try and suggest we're going towards A, but let's go B because B is weak. But they just, I don't know, they just, I mean, nobody, it seemed that nobody was watching the clock.
Yeah, that's a mistake that cannot happen in a major.
Yeah, they basically just threw it around.
Yep.
So too many mistakes from CLG may cost them the first map of this best of three. Again, the second one is going to be Cobble.
The only thing to save them is their big bank. They don't really have to worry about the size of their monies. Got lots of cash in the bank to buy everything up again. And we'll see Fugly taking control of middle very easily. Once again, you know, Gambit just give up middle pretty much every round for free. That is the setup that they prefer, it seems. And they only have, you know, after losing Hooch, they've only got Waylander by headshot on B. That's all that there is to be said of that B defense. But hey, I mean, Mo hits a great shot just there, all the way down to the white box in middle.
Yeah, but going back to Old Faithful are the CLG side. And who knows if they can win this round. Again, the money's going to be a bit poor for Gambit, but they'll have one more buy in it. So they're just going to come in with no nades, no warning whatsoever. But there is a player, that's Dozier, waiting for the cross, but the smoke has gone down and Haze will get him through. Great timing from him. So again, Gambit still not realizing that CLG just going back to B again and again and
it
again.
It just happens every time. Oh my goodness, it's really frustrating to watch as well from that perspective for Gambit, because you know you see this problem that they're having, and it's basically a trade-off as well to their style, which is so incredibly passive. They're always being beaten out on the rotation, and in some rounds you would see Mo and Adren actually try to go for the retake here when it's really unfavorable. They're just too late, and this time they didn't. But yeah, it seems like CLG are only losing rounds in which they defeat themselves on the T side, instead of Gambit defeating their rounds.
For me, the question is, can Gambit make the adjustment and realize that CLG are taking B every round? It's every round.
It is basically every round, James.
So they should be able to get a buy here. They can buy around these weapons. And indeed, they are going to do that, it seems. So let's see how many grenades the CT side will get out. We've got three smokes, four smokes, a bunch of flashbangs as well. But I mean, really, really, it comes down to, are CLG going to take the B-bomb site again? And if so, can Gambit adjust to it? The default comes out from both sides. The bomb's towards A main on this occasion, with two people looking for a fast engagement towards A, actually. You can see Fugly very close. JDM gonna shoot Dozier. And Adren's going to answer, taking down Taric, but everything's going to slow down. We've got a smoke in A main, but again, it's another round where CLG get a fast pick. Cutler, though, has stuck as Wayland's getting aggressive, and that's going to be some great information for his team. And now CLG don't know. I mean, in the death cam, they'll see Waylander move back a little bit, but there's no guarantee that Gambit aren't pushing B. And you can see how stretched out CLG are now. JDM's in squeaky. Fugly is running towards B on his own with the bomb, and Haze is in mid.
Yeah. Yeah, getting a kill there, he could still be in toxic for all they know. So this is a really, really terrible situation for CLG. But that said, you know, Gambit already did lose one player and Wayland is pretty low, so definitely an opportunity here for them. And they're going to try to get the play onto the A site. They haven't been there for a while, but let's see if they can make it work here. We've got Hooch by the NBK position, and Wayland are going to get snapped down by Haze. Hooched in. Hooch is in right there with two quick kills. And now it's down to Fugly, one versus three. And will Hooch get burned down? He's actually able to avoid the flames there.
He's got one HP, that.
This is ridiculous. I can't believe he's still alive. Finally, he's going to get caught by the flames. It will spread, and he's done for. Barbecued by Fugly, and now one versus two. 30 seconds on the clock. The bomb goes down. Ooh, just barely getting himself out of that position. But he's death to three HP, and that's going to be that. Adren will get the frag on the Fugly. And, oh my goodness. Finally, James, Gambit are going to be able to take this one. But they were hemorrhaging badly there.
One thing you have to realize about CIS teams, Na'Vi aside, is that they've never won until they are completely over the line. You never know what's going to happen. But again, that could have been a 14-1 half in when Gambit were on the T side for them against CLG. But they messed up. Yeah. It was just a catalog of errors from both teams, basically.
The crazy thing for me is just the lack of adaptation from Gambit in the last half of the CT side for them. And the other thing as well is that Mo Finished on 28 frags, but I think until the last couple rounds, he'd only made 5 frags in about 10 or 11 rounds of the, you know, the second half. So
he fell off basically.
So Mo fell off massively after the first half.
Fell off like Jar Rule Dan.
And you know, one of the reasons, you know, for that, I suppose, is the fact that he was playing mid incredibly passively and often just playing as a rotation into A, as instead of, you know, an A player or actually being enabled in middle in some way. So yeah, that hyper-passive play style, giving CLG all that space. I mean, what would have happened, for example, let's say that round where CLG just ran out of time, for example.
Yeah.
What if they played that round, you know, more correctly? Then Gambit are money screwed, and CLG, you know, they just get that eco, and then boom, they'll probably take it over the line.
Yeah, it seems to be a case of whoever makes the least mistakes is winning by that virtue, basically.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
At the moment. So I think the desks are ready to continue the analysis, so over to Richard.
Thanks a lot for that, fellas. Lovely hat as well, James. Looking like a Conehead. It's unreal, isn't it? But anyway, a great first map. Very close. The battle between the old enemies and friends now, of course, America and Russia.
For now.
Yeah, we'll see how that one pans out. But Gambit won. And, of course, a lot of you guys were saying, well, you felt that this was going to be close, but you gave the edge to CLG. Well, Gambit have now got one foot in that stadium. Just a real good performance, despite key components of CLG being on point. You know, JDM brought the AWP, and it looked like maybe they could have done something. So, initial thoughts.
First of all, Mo played great. I think when Mo first got brought into Hellraisers, he was supposed to be the new guy that came in, kind of like a new simple, right? But yeah. With a better attitude.
A real new simple, though.
Yeah, and obviously it didn't really turn out. And then this is essentially like a team made from the teams that either were in previous teams of like Hellraisers or former 1.6 teams with Dosha, and they just decided to make a team together with Wayland. I think he's like Finnish/Russian
he's
or something.
He's Finnish, yeah.
And one thing to note is like it's extremely hard to play against CIS teams, mainly because they're super random, and that's why like Hellraisers are always like hard to play against, even though they're not a top 10 team anymore. But this team, actually, I'm very surprised because they mix their randomness with a lot of set strats.
Yeah.
And on top of that, they have that slow mentality as well, but they can also do a set strat on the fly, which is something that not all of the CIS teams actually do. That most of the teams just run around one by one, and they just try and aim heads, right? They do the same in some aspects, but they also have teamwork, which is, I mean, I'm actually quite impressed by how Gambit is playing so far in the tournament. On the other note, CLG, yeah, sure, they may have lost this map, but I feel like they're playing a lot better now with Pete on in the coaching role. Yeah. There was a lot of issues with CLG in the past with how they communicated with one another, how the teamwork went, and just general map awareness. And I think that they fixed most of that, and they are playing better. It's just right now, it's just they probably never played a team like Gambit before, so it's probably hard to adjust.
Well, I'll bring Yanko in at this point. What did you notice CLG were doing wrong? You know, I saw you kind of slapping your head at times backstage, and didn't want to ask why, because sometimes you get locked in your own private rituals. So what was going on? What was frustrating you?
I mean, what frustrated me the most was the fact that they, after winning Pistol in the second half, they lose the anti-force buy round, right? And looking at how the game ended 16-13, imagine if they had a 3-0 start in the second half, that would have probably ended up, you know, winning them the game in the end. And they did lose the first half Pistol round as well, so they got off to 2 bad starts, basically. And okay, the first half was really messy, it was going back and forth, both teams losing anti-force buy rounds, but in the end, I really feel that they should have taken this map, considering that Waylander, who was the, you know, driving force of Gambit in that game against Envious on Cash, had a terrible performance. I'm not sure if he got to double digits in kills in that map. Yeah. So, I mean, in the end, it was Gambit's pick. So you might say, okay, CLG maybe didn't even have to win this map. Maybe they can win Cobble now and in the end Mirage. But it was really close. They could have taken it.
Well, Duncan, you must have something to add to that. Yeah. We're finding out more and more about this Gambit team. I mean, me and you obviously worked the last chance qualifier where we saw them looking very good on train, but against weaker opposition. And
sure,
then
yeah.
Since then, they've got better every time we've saw them. Where do you rate this performance?
It was certainly solid. It ended up actually being the inverse of what I expected from the game. Like, the reason why I actually had CLG winning this is I thought CLG will have like a solid enough CT half, and they'll probably have a decent T half. And I thought to myself, the way the game yesterday went against Envious was T half was where the guys struggled in Gambit, actually. They had a lot of problems closing it out, and they got progressively worse and worse. And it looked eventually like they were just trying to win purely by head showing people. Well, this time around, obviously, the T side was fantastic in comparison to that. They were having a lot of ease taking over all the sites. Obviously, Mo's AWPing was absolutely unlocking everything for them, and he was actually the best AWPer in the game, which, when you consider previously the pedestal we've put JDM on, where he was very consistent for CLG, it's a pretty good little feather to have in your cap, as it were. The only problem, I think, in general for the Gambit team is, like, I think that style, if CLG was a bit smart, I think they could figure that style out more. Like, I think the thing about the CIS region teams is they always have this, like, passive style. And it always feels like they never fully commit to, like, say they're all going to A. They will be heading towards A. They'll start to move into A. But it's like every single person within the strategy still wants to take, like, a favorable aim duel. And that's why they go so slowly and they set it up. But as a result, you can't just, like, push for information and then rush it. If you will, the guy who's the lurker will just be waiting for you there. And he'll wait till essentially they're inside the site. So it makes it very difficult. For teams like North American teams particularly, they want the information. They want to be able to make a read and to know where we're going to go in that sense. You can't really get that out of the CIS teams, I think. So I think that was part of CLG's problem. They either were just stuck in the sites with no information, or you're going to push up, you're trying to risk something, and actually that's going to lead to them getting open sites in themselves because you're pushing into them when they're on the T side. I mean, actually, I had a podcast where I talked to Fallen, and on this topic, kind of a pertinent point, he said that for the slower teams like Luminosity, like Na'Vi, he feels like they almost have to think now about the T side as just a weaker CT side, essentially. Like, you set up your area, you take over the map control.
The CT side is a weak T side.
I think it was the other way around, because he meant when you take, like, map control as T-side, and then you essentially just play, like, defensively in that. Like, you defend the area you've got the control of and see if the CT's push back into it. Thanks for contradicting me anyway. Synergy we always expect from each other.
I was in the same podcast, that's why.
Yeah, but you left at that point. So, anyway. You're about to leave this one, mate, in a minute. So, anyway. Overall, I don't think it was, like, some fantastic comeback by CLG. Like, they did a decent job, but they'd just given up way too much in the first half. You could tell it was going to be almost impossible to win that game. They did their best. In general, I have to say, that doesn't really make me that confident in CLG going into the next map. Like, even though I don't think it's a map that's good for Gambit at all, the way they're fragging, the way their actual players have played for the whole tournament, it's been pretty decent overall. So I feel like at the moment they've got the performances. So I think CLG is going to have to rely on the routine on Cobblestone.
All right, well, look, thanks a lot for your thoughts, gentlemen. And to all the people out there, obviously, do find that podcast and let's find out who was right.
Let's see who was right, eh?
Yeah, it wasn't even Fallen. It was MBK who said that the CT sides are the weak T sides.
We've all had a drink, Yanko. Anyway, so what we're going to do is...
Let's see who was right. That's all I'm going to say.
We're going to take a five-minute break. When we come back, we're going to see which one of these two teams is going to win Cobblestone. Do join us.
Nice job. if you want to achieve something in this game, you have to really work hard. And during your career, a lot of ups and downs. And the thing is, like, how you're gonna react on that. Remember that you're playing in a team. It's not a solo game. It's a team play.
Gambit. Yeah. Failed to qualify for the last major. There was no Oceanic region that was represented, but now they've got a chance to get into this major right away.
First place is hard working. We played a lot, we trained a lot, we discussed a lot. The second thing was team chemistry. We feel we are all friends in team. We got a new guy, but we feel like he's playing long time with us.
Gambit playing out of their minds. That's one way to say it.
Counter-Strike is a big part of my life. I've met a lot of people, visited a lot of countries all over the world. I love to compete and I like to travel and I like to meet new people. I'm thankful to my mom that she made me learn English so I can talk to people. And to be honest, a lot of people didn't expect and think that I'm gonna make it. But I found my team, I found my players, and we worked and we achieved it.
Gambit, with basically zero experience beyond the CIS minor, just completely crushed them.
I'm excited about the growing CSGO because it's happening right now when I'm playing, and it's becoming like a big sport now. It can be like football or basketball. So I'm excited that it's happening when I'm playing.
Gambit definitely working as a unit.
I'll be honest, I didn't pay any attention to them. I didn't even have them getting out of this group, but they did it in fine style. I mean, they humiliated Cloud9 here. So they're definitely no joke.
Good looking guy at the end of that video. Anyway, welcome back to the CSGO Major here in Columbus, Ohio. I'm your host, Richard Lewis, filling in for Scoots while we're getting the rehearsal ready for the awesome show we've got for you tomorrow. Can't say anything about it. Don't want to give any spoilers away. And we've got better things to talk about because we're in the middle of an amazing series between CLG and Gambit Gaming. So, guys, Fiflarin, Yanko, and Thorin, we've already seen one map in the books. Gambit have won it. They've got the advantage. CLG need to battle back, but this is a map that's very much in their wheelhouse. What are your thoughts?
I mean, it is the LG's map pick, so obviously, like Yanko was saying before, wouldn't really for CLG, I wouldn't really think too much into cash, because it's when you're playing a top team, you're essentially hoping or you're essentially thinking you're gonna lose their map pick anyway, right? And just come in and win your map pick and then win the third one. So for CLG, they looked a little bit down after that first game. I think that they realized that they made a lot of mistakes.
Yeah.
But as long as PETA clears their head a little bit here, I think that could potentially end up in their favor, but Gambit is looking good. I actually think that Gambit might just take this 2-0.
I mean, I actually agree with this. It's not the fact that only that CLG lost the first map. It's also the manner in which they lost. They lost a lot of clutch rounds at times. They made some mistakes with overpeaking and so on, so they should really focus on fixing that. I really feel that Cobblestone will go the way of CLG, seeing as they also defeated Envious on day one, I think. And looking at Gambit, they didn't play a lot of Cobble, and it was only against, you know, tier 3 teams and so on. They do start on the T side in this game, so what I can see going for them is maybe if they win the pistol and get rolling, you know, have a couple of a good aggressive rounds, maybe more with the op, and then maybe they can catch CLG off guard. But in the end, I feel this will go to Mirage.
Yeah, and Duncan, that's got to be the fear, hasn't it, for CLG, what Yanko's talking about. With Gambit starting on that T side, you need to get an AWP into JDM's hands as quickly as possible, because we know he's not good with any other gun.
Yeah, and he's always a big key to this map particularly. Yeah. This is the one where he's very good at. I've always thought Cobble, for me, along with when they had their Mirage, was pretty decent. Those were the two maps they could at least compete internationally with the top tier teams. In terms of Gambit, okay, the fragging's going well for Gambit, so they can be a factor in that sense, but I think this map has CLG written all over it, because Gambit have actually only played it 6 times in any context in 2016. It's mainly been online competition, and actually against like tier 3 and tier 4 opponents, so it's not a map that they're familiar with, it's not a map that they're good on, they've never shown us anything on this map, so unless they have some amazing fragging performance, I don't think it's going to happen for them, especially because that very slow style that they have, I don't think it's going to work out so well on this map without like proper set strategies. So I think this is CLG's bounce back. They win this map and we're going to 3 for this one, I think.
Okay, well, that's what Duncan thinks. So what do you two think? I mean, both think the CLG is going to take Cobblestone?
I said Gambit. I'm going to stick with that.
You're going to stick with that?
Yeah. I think we're going to Mirage.
Okay, well, thanks for your thoughts, gentlemen. The team's ready. We're going to get into this game now. So it is going to be Cobblestone. Take it away.
Take it away, who? You forget my name over there?
Huh?
I just want to give a shout out to the guy who is listening on audio and driving, and he's making an 8-hour journey to come to MLG tomorrow. But don't play with your phone while you're driving, otherwise I'll call you a massive bitch. We're about 30 seconds away from the second map of this best of three, which is going to be Cobble. Now, personally, I expect this to be comfortable for CLG. It's a map we've seen them play earlier on in this tournament. They played it well. How do you feel, Dan?
I feel like this is a pretty damn great map for CLG. You know, historically, they always like to try to angle for the cobblestones and the dust twos. If you, you know, check their map history, and they don't tend to do too badly on them. As mentioned already on the desk, JDM. This is, you know, where JDM can really perform. So Gambit, they're going to need to actually outstrat their opponents in this one. I think individually, I think CLG are going to be on top of this. So unless Waylander can really pick things up, because last map he looked a little bit quiet, to be honest, from our expectations. But if he can pick it up, you know, who knows what's going to happen. And we're about to find out regardless as we jump into the pistol. And CLG will have the honor of starting on the Counter-Terra side.
Just a very quick nerd thing. While the countdown was going on there, Tarik was trying to bunny hop from the top of the crack in the wall onto the tree position. I'm not even sure if that's possible, but he was trying it repeatedly. So maybe it is. Someone post a video if it is. The entire Gambit team are going over towards A, and producer says it's possible. That's great. So it's Tarik alone who is holding down the A site. He's going to win the duel with Mo, but he should hear lots of flanking. But Hooch is flanking Tarik, but Hooch has got the bomb and he's on his own. If he loses that duel, then he's going to lose the whole round potentially. What is he doing? He's still dueling with Tarik. Why? He's won it, but that's crazy. Dozier's on the site on his own. There might not be a plant now because he's so far away. He's got to cross the Red Sea to get a plant on the A site. A Cutler and JDM. Oh, there now. Oh, Hooch took a massive gamble there, and that might cost his team a lot of money. And he is going to have Fugly shoot him straight in the face, Dan. It was a valiant effort. Did he not realize he had the bomb? I don't know if he realized that, but I mean,
I'm afraid to know the answer, James.
Like, they could have got a plant there, at least they could have got a plant there. It's like, I must kill this guy, like he's Terminator or something. And I don't know.
Well, we get double P90s, so CLG going to rub it in a little bit. Gambit, of course, as you said, a little bit of an over. I mean, they must have overlooked that massively. I mean, a bomb plant here, and they can, you know, they could do all kinds of things. They could, you know, save for late case next round.
They could force
in this round and get an execute out, and that would be really sick as well. On this map, you can do some super sick executes with Tech Nines. Anyway, they've left the bomb towards the Dragon Lord tapestry, towards the.
You know, I calmed down, Dan. I calmed down from the nonsense in the previous game, and I'm just tilted first round.
Well. Gambit, it's quite interesting because, of course, they don't really have any grenades. They've got one smoke. And right now, they just left the bomb in hallways there with a Dren, who's actually pushed up by B-Plat. So, interesting stuff here. At least gaining some map control is Gambit at the moment. Waylander's quite far pushed up on A-Long, and Tarik's getting close to his position. Now, they've got to go get the bomb, and the Dren also with a lot of control towards Plats, but the thing is they don't have drop. That'd be really nice if they had a guy in the drop zone at the moment, but that's really dangerous in a round like this when the P90 is all over the place. But it looks like it's time to go for it, James.
Looks like Hooch is going to get shot in the face with MP9, surely. Oh, he's dancing around the corner, and JDM's running out of bullets. Tarik's going to hold the high ground and take down Waylander, cover Tarik's JDM's back. And Hooch will be forced to rotate, because now they have nobody on the high ground. Meanwhile, Moe's putting in work at Tech Nine. Can't get the second frag, though. The bomb is on the B bomb site now. Can they get a plant this time? Dozier's alone, still going for the deagle kills. Really, his team need a bomb plant here, but he wants to get the kills, Dan. He wants to win the round, it seems. Not going to get any kills, not going to get a bomb plant. And Hooch is on the wrong side of the entire site, so there are two opportunities, you could say, for Gambit to get bomb plants, but they just don't want to plant the bomb, Dan.
I don't understand, James, because if he planted the bomb, he could have afforded another deagle. It pays for the next round deagle. Plus, he gets $300 from planting the bomb.
Perhaps Gambit are not a team who are about bomb plants, Dan. Perhaps that's what's going on here.
We've got a pause coming in as well from Tarik, so I guess that must be technical. Perhaps a TeamSpeak issue, maybe?
Yeah, we've got admins coming over towards the team. I don't know, someone's holding a pair of headphones, so it's hard to say what exactly the problem is, but hopefully it will be resolved shortly. So, we've had two opportunities for, I mean, again, because Gambit are a relatively new team, it's hard to have enough of a sample size to say how good or bad they might be at perhaps any map. But Cobblestone, I mean, Hooch chasing the flanker on his own, I mean, either go with someone, or go to the site with the bomb.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
But don't
yeah.
don't leave your teammates going to the site and go there with the bomb. So I'm assuming either he didn't have, no, he had the bomb, maybe someone threw it to him in the middle
yeah,
of the round.
Yeah, because the entire point is you always need to just secure at least the bomb plant. That's like the fallacy, because then at least you can just get the pressure back onto the CTs. And you get such sick options from doing it. Either you get the third round AKs, which is insane, because the CTs can't kind of out firepower you then, because they can't have warps. And they need to have nades, so they can't risk, you know, just going for the M4s and then having no nades on the CT side and play Angels against you. So, you know, you have such great options, but if by staying behind, what's going to happen? Well, his team might get the bomb site, but by the time he gets there, they're all dead, James.
Yeah, and in fairness to Dozier, he doesn't know how close people are to the bombs, to the B bomb site when he has the bomb there. That said, he was only looking to his left towards the door. And if he only thinks people are there, then he has time to plant the bomb and give his team a bit more money, but perhaps his focus was
on economical damage.
Well, I mean,
it's just kind of weird, kind of sloppy stuff at the start.
Yeah, I mean, there are some situations where perhaps, you know, there's more than one right option. Maybe there isn't a wrong option.
No chance.
So I mean, looking at the angle, looking at the angle he was holding with the deagle, it's reasonable to expect a headshot to come. But when you're not getting it, I don't know.
But he's not winning the rounds. But what he can do is assure that the team gets more money. Or it mostly gets one kill. And well, that's just not... You want to take care of your economy in this spot.
Yeah, well, I mean, there is... I think there is an argument to the CT economy. And again, the nades and straining the economy for future rounds. So perhaps that was his priority. We may never know, Dan.
I don't know. Because the thing is that if you take that logic about the opponent's economy, then by planting the bomb, if they decide... Because they wouldn't have enough money to full buy this round, but they could quasi buy. They could actually get, you know, P250s and some nades, and yep. their chances to actually make kills and pressure the economy goes way up in comparison to that one engagement with the deagle where he maybe tops gets one.
That is true. We have also seen some eco executes towards the A sites where, to be honest, in fairness, the CT side you could argue had weird setups where the ecoing players were allowed to get very close to the site and then they just overran it. And that's without nades. I remember because I was saying, why don't you get any flashbangs? And they managed to cause absolute havoc with only P250s. But there are indeed a lot of things people can do. You know, you can get your flashbang into the drop zone, take drop and try and split that way, or just spam a few flashbangs over the wall. There are many, a multitude of things that can be done. So,
I bet the viewers are loving the pauses, James. There's Dragon Laws.
There's been a lot of cobblestone.
Yeah.
There has.
More time for Dragon Laws. You have a Dragon Law. I do not.
I do have a Dragon Law. You have a Man of War.
Yeah.
I have...
I opened the case.
I actually have almost, if not every AWP skin there is.
Actually, really?
Yeah.
Wow.
I have loads. I have a Lightning, AWP Lightning, with the Holo Dignitas sticker on, which is mad gangster. But the problem is, I have a Medusa and a Dragon Law, so when am I going to use any other skin?
Yeah, of course.
So I've got a Medusa on the CT side, Dragon Lore on the T side.
Give them away,
you've got to go with the cool blues.
Give them away on stream.
No.
You're just going to hoard them.
We gave away a Dragon Lore on stream once. But it's kind of boring, to be honest. It's more interesting to, for example, open a cobblestone case for a subscriber and then have absolute failure, Dan. Or do a trade-up with one knight and then random crap and get an all chameleon, Dan. I was almost crying with laughter
Why don't you share the joy and the love? You're like Smog. Hoarding all the treasure.
People can share the joy by tuning into my stream. That's what they can do.
All right. Fair enough then.
Yeah.
Fair enough. I can't stream because my internet is poverty, James.
So is mine.
We're actually living basically like almost on the same street.
Yeah.
So I guess what it applies to
I was carrying my PC to work on the weekend to stream for my loyal fans, but...
I don't have the dedication to carry my PC there.
I ended up going buying an over-the-top PC to do that.
But now, really
now
portable,
we've moved office,
right?
And we have crap internet in our new office until the new one comes in.
Didn't you have like a shuttle or something? Some kind of a shuttle.
I have micro? No, mine's mini ITX. Yeah. But it looks like a micro ATX, but it's mini ITX. But it's a tiny box. It's awesome because I got to take it to LAN as well. We have some of the CLG female team here. I know, I think Benita is here, as is Miss Harvey. So there are some teammates for CLG to give some... to give them a little boost. I think the manager is here as well. So you can see there are still, well, you can't see actually because of the overlay. There are still some admins fiddling around with something. I think it's a headset. I think there might be a bit of a headset issue over there. Can we just marvel at how swag JDM is? let me see if I can. Where's my little handle here? Okay, I can't find the handle.
I was going to try and lean back,
yeah, but I can't because I might just fall off the chair or something. But it's insane. He just plays
all the way back.
I don't know any other player. Because yeah. Some players, you have your screen here, right, and they just play like this, where it's like an IMAX. It's like a poor man's IMAX, Dan.
I like the Russian style. We have the keyboard on your lap, and you have your arm like right directly in front of you, kind of like bent at like a 90-degree angle, Russian style. All good as well. It's lots of different. It's so interesting how you know everyone picks different setups and stuff. But the Russian style setup came from the fact that in the old days, people had way smaller desks because smaller desks and huge CRTs which take up the entire desk.
We are so back into the match, Dan. They have figured out whatever they need to figure out. It's great.
Nice.
So, CT setup. We have Cutler going hyper aggressive in long A, but he's not going to go all the way towards the peak as. Test of time has stopped CTs from doing that. So we're going to have four Gambit players over towards B bomb site. Smokes down towards B plateau. Not going to have any early presence there from Gambit. Now, I do wonder how they're going to play the drop zone. Indeed, this is an eco, so it's not really a suggestion as to how a normal play might be from Gambit. And they're splitting the site, but they've only got Glocks pretty much. So again, if they had that plant, maybe they get PT-50s and it makes a difference. The bomb's gone down and they will be easy frag for CLG. So again, if Dozio gets the plant in the previous round, then they get PT-50s, maybe they get a bomb plant there or even more because they got close enough for the one-tap stand. But with the Glocks, they need more than a one-tap.
Yeah, and indeed they do. Now that 3-0 is going to be a pretty comfortable start and I'm really curious considering the kind of weirdness that we've seen at the start of the map. You know, what we're going to get from Gambit, from the execution side of things, you know, all the nades and so on, the placements, the timings, the coordination on the pushes. This round, they don't really have much in the way of Molotovs, which is kind of a painful, only two flashbangs as well. So it's going to be difficult to kind of breach, drop and so on with such, you know, few Molotovs and flashbangs. But they're going to give it a go, pushing in a
B-plat with a Dren. From JDM. This is the kind of aggression that we haven't really seen from other AWPers in this match. Again, when Kenny was playing for Envy, he was pretty much up here where JDM is now, closer to the doors. But it can be common for AWPers to look towards the boulder at the beginning of a round as sloppy T's, you know, move towards A long. You can easily get a frag there if people look on the wrong side of the boulder. But there we go. So we've got two Gambit Gaming players just looking for opportunities towards the drop, but CLG will be another of these CT sides who don't have a presence within the drop itself. Maybe that changes later on as it is early days on the CT, in this match.
Yeah, and a lot of time has passed, so we see much more passive positions now from CLG, and Haze is kind of covering Connector, but you know, they really don't feel comfortable in drop anymore as Hooch is in there. So look how Gambit are just encroaching upon the bomb site now. They're really close into this push, and I'm not confident in CLG's setup here. This is going to be really tough to hold this. P90's not good enough. Fugly stuck behind the statue with a FAMAS. He's going to be able to get the kill on the Dren, dancing left and right on the statue. Now it's down to his teammates. Haze comes into play with the FAMAS, but you cannot stop this onslaught of T players. It was three players, but now it's just two left here for Gambit. But JDM, with that AWP, he's going to find it really difficult to find his way back into a fragging situation. Oh, great shot, though. Door is no longer smoked off. And JDM makes full use of the visibility. Now just Mo to kill. Ooh. Barely getting out of harm's way there for Mo. And he's got to go for the plant. Is he actually burning? No, he's actually avoided the fire here. And here goes JDM. Scoping up. Great shot from JDM. He's going to secure it there. And that is a beautiful clutch there. From the Yorper, from the man with the plan.
Captain Cadillac running over these fools.
Captain Cadillac.
See, now, normally, well, not normally, in the past, we've seen JDM playing the B bombsite with the AWP, and if he was there in that situation, then Gambit probably would have been wrecked earlier on. Look at him there, just cruising through the map. He was on the A bombsite on this occasion, so I'm expecting perhaps they're going to rotate him a bit. I mean, Waylander kind of offered himself, you know, for sacrifice as well. I don't know what you think about that, but the point is, JDM has, you could argue, even been a crutch for CLG the way they've previously played the B bombsite, and he is indeed moving towards B on this occasion. But if he's alive, he's so dangerous. Despite playing on the A bombsite, Gambit didn't get strong enough positioning on B fast enough to stop CLG streaming through the door, and I think that was the problem that lost him the round there.
Nice little flash there into the boost as well from JDM. So let's see if he can get some more monstrous work done with the AWP, and that smoke leaves a bit of a gap to be exploited, and that's what's going to happen. Adrenaline's out of the picture. That's not very fortunate here for Gambit. Now they have to try to figure out, okay, how are we going to hold? How are we going to deal with this round now? Because JDM's still taking shots here. Oh no, this goes from bad to worse now for Gambit. They've lost two players to JDM. They have not gained anything in return. Trying to take drop zone now. There's a trade coming in. That's not going to help either. This is terrible right now for Gambit. What do they do?
Dozier can perhaps find something here. Not sure if he saw the behind there. His teammate is miles away though, so he gets a frag, but he needs to hold down this choke point, and he's got no nades to do it, which means that JDM is going to come creeping like Henry G in the club, Dan.
Well, it's very quiet now as Gambit are trying to lure their opponents into some of these angles, but Cutler will win that battle. Mo versus 3 with the AK. Oh, the nade's coming over. Snap into the first player. There he goes. JDM, next person perhaps, but no. Fugly gets the frag, and the round will be won by CLG. Although Gambit did salvage something. They got a bomb plant, which is kind of sick, and an extra frag or two, which honestly wasn't expected after the start being so dire. Two players going down to JDM. I mean, they need to create a solution there. Do they challenge JDM directly, like Mo 1 versus 1 on the plat, AWP versus AWP, or do they try to smoke him off and Molotov him out of that position?
I'm disappointed that JDM's avatar isn't like at a 45 degree angle backwards or a 90 degree angle backwards.
So tilted, yeah.
Yeah. Well, he is cruising. And again, I thought this would be a comfortable map for CLG. We'll see if he goes for the aggression towards the boulder again. Indeed, he is. This is, that cart. Dozier is going to be seen, but not eliminated on this occasion. But I like that aggression. I don't know why we haven't seen so much of it from other CTs, from some losing CT side. They could have really benefited from such aggression. Looking over the smoke as well. JDM so comfortable with DWP, and he is going to be a problem going forward for Gambit, especially because As effective as Mo was on the T side of Cash, I don't think the design of this map lends itself to his style of AWPing. I did say that when Fnatic were playing, and they went double AWP on the T side, but Gambit are not Fnatic.
No, far from it. Far from it. Now we have Gambit once again very far pushed up onto this B split. Got the players into drop now and starting to push up on the plateau, but JDM holding it down once again. Waylander will get the trade though, and we start to initiate the madness. Ugly though, look at this, beautiful stuff there. And you got to question Gambit's coordination into that one, as Fugly shouldn't be allowed to kind of 180 like that. But 6-0, CLG look to be having an easy time right now.
For those of you watching on GoTV, I would just keep an eye on JDM because he is playing very, very aggressively now. And you saw Dozier got taken down there by Fugly. I think it was him who Fugly should have killed already when he went for a peek. But I think JDM just moved before firing, so his shot was inaccurate because his crosshair was definitely dead on. So, again, I mean, also looking at how aggressive JDM is being allowed to play now, it feels like we thought CLG would be comfortable in this map, but it feels like their confidence is going to be having a massive resurgence going into map 3 should they continue to be good. I mean, that's not a look of confidence I'm seeing there in the Gambit camp on this map.
No, absolutely not. It's up to CLG to find ways to enable JDM to put these performances in, and he's getting to do whatever the hell he likes on B plateau at the moment, which is obviously not going to be favorable for Gambit. So I would like to see them, you know, use grenades to try to, you know, kind of get rid of him from some of these positions where he can actually pick, and maybe put him under more pressure where maybe he's stuck behind the statue or something on the B site or something, you know, more to that degree, or even maybe just incentivizing him to try to go to A for a round or something instead of just you know, straight up facing him. Because let's say look at that round where they lost two players, just one versus one. You can't trade there. It's incredibly hard to trade there. They'd have to basically get Mo to peak with somebody, but they're going one at a time into JDM, and that's just not going to work.
It's not, and I feel like one of the other strengths of JDM going over towards B and playing aggressively is that it's very unlikely that Gambit are going to go A in a fast fashion. So they seemingly can't avoid him.
Yeah.
Anyway, we're going to go back into the game very shortly, and we'll see what they have to offer. It looks like it's going to be a bit of a a mixed buy. I mean, Wayland has bought an AK and has $100 left in the bank, but the rest of his team have about 2K, and they've bought up armor and Tech-9s with a few nades. So maybe they're going to do some spam flashbangs over the B wall, and then Wayland leads the charge. We will find out very shortly indeed.
Yeah, and it's... I hope it's, you know, they start getting something going for them at this position. But, you know, the whole JDM factor is, generally speaking, against a great operator, it's hard to trade on this map. Kenny S, another good example. Not trying to draw a comparison between anyone and Kenny S, but
Kenny as the epitome. Kenny was playing super passive in his angles towards A when Envy were on this map, but there we go. It is going to be a fast B with Gambit charging into the site. Loads of counter flashes coming in, though, and they're going to be largely blind and largely dead, Dan, but they've got two frags from Waylander, and it's Waylander alone now with that AK that he started with versus three. Cutler is quite heavily tagged, and he has an opportunity to get himself some one versus ones, but he's been spotted now, and the CTs will adjust. Almost a two-man spray down, but it's a zero-man spray down. Cutler doing the job, surviving for his team, and the AWP is rescued by Tarek. Cutler surviving with one HP.
Yeah, this looks really easy right now for CLG. They look so confident. They even start to pick up double AWP. And double AWP on this map can be...
Ooh, that spray down is absolutely disgusting. And glorious at the same time.
The good kind of disgusting.
The good kind of disgusting, Dan.
All right, so yeah, double AWP indeed. They're going to send Tarek as one of the two AWPers. Obviously, JDM is the other one. JDM taking his usual positions towards the B-bomb site. Tarek actually going towards into danger, so playing some more off angles with the AWP and just trying to get himself into those tight spots. But it's hard to fall back from this. If you get two players pushing you, you'll hit the first shot. He's going to jump backwards. And Waylander not quite quick enough. The smoke goes down. The pistol comes out. And that's the headshot for Waylander. Bit of an error there from Tarek, perhaps. We'll have to see how punished CLG will be by Tarek going down in that position.
See, that shows inexperience from the T side, because in the cobblestone matches we've seen earlier in this tournament, that angle that Tarek has been holding gets flashed every time. I think when Chris J was holding that, for example, he was getting flashed off the wall there.
Yeah.
But Gambit just serving themselves up once again. So you can see this is not a strong map for Gambit already. But Tarek holding that angle with no support, he should know that he's susceptible to a flashbang there, because he could have been taken down for free.
Yeah, and the A split's being set up now. Adren would really love to get into drop zone, but it looks like he's still kind of contemplating whether or not he's going to commit to that. But Dozy is ready to go up middle. Waylander and Hooch are ready to push in from A long. You can see Haste in this position by the wooden fence. It's going to be very key. Oh, can't get the first kill, actually. It's going to be a quick snap from Waylander. That's going to do the damage. And now here comes the push onto the bomb site. Looks like Adren will go down in the lurking position. Cutler spraying down Hooch and Waylander, leaving Dozier left alive. He'll take down one in connector, but he's got to reclaim the bomb. 20 seconds left against Cutler. Goes for the spray. Dozier gets it done, and Gambit posts around finally onto the scoreboard.
Welcome to the scoreboard, Gambit Gaming. But one round is not going to be enough. They need consecutive rounds now, because should they lose this one and get completely wiped out, it's going to give CounterLogic Gaming a good opportunity to string a few rounds together with relative ease, because the offense from Gambit will be limited due to lack of funds. No cash in the bank, no stacks, no Skrilla, because Foreign will have taken it all.
So, Lord.
Six round lead for CLG. There will be an AWP onto both sides. Mo has picked up the AWP on this occasion, so Waylander won't be keeping it. But we'll see what Mo has to offer. Adren with a great start, JDM going down. This is like old-style cobble where you see people just run up to the plateau and just start shooting people in the face. Speaking of being shot in the face, Cutler will return the favor.
And here they go. Tarek just sitting in there by the smoke. And he's going to hear any stepping. Waylander is making a lot of noise, I think, at A long. He's still running around there, so Tarek should be able to hear that. And here goes the flash. Tarek in the smoke. He's going to hear more stepping, but I think he's past Dozier. They're both just kind of passing like ships in the night, only for a moment. And now all the players of Gambit funneling up through A long. And Haste is right at the back of the A bomb site. Really needs some support coming in here
in
now.
The back.
Oh, Tarek finding a quick frag onto Mo. That's a really big frag. Haste will get a quick flash in there. And Waylander, oh, wins the 1-on-1. And now it's a 2 versus 3. Bomb goes down here in favor of Gambit. Pressure has been put onto the two remaining players of CLG.
Cutler's on the balcony, but Fugly is stuck behind the smoke, which has now disappeared from the door. But again, man disadvantage, and it's really hard to push that door because there are too many angles to find. But he's going to shoot someone in the face regardless. Hooch having a quick look, seeing where he is, but he's not going to give him the opportunity to shoot him in the face. He's going to force CLG to push and then try and punish them for it. Despite the shadow there, Hooch will get the frag onto Cutler. Fugly doesn't know what's going on fast enough. Stuck in a crossfire, he will be finished off. So Gambit get that consecutive round that they needed. 7-2.
It's actually funny how much of a kind of like a help, but also a hindrance that shadow is in that position. But here we can see Wayland just going ham though into the site, getting the entries required. There's the flash, but Wayland gets the pop onto Hayes. Really, really important play there. But 7-2, Gambit starting to get some rounds, but 7 already is a pretty big deal on this map on
Indeed,
the CT side.
That said, had CLG won that round, again, they would have had momentum in their favor, economically speaking, but their economics have been broken. The books have been burned, Dan. They are pretty poor, got a few pistols here and there, no nades to speak of whatsoever, no dirty peaks from the boys in blue, if you will. There are four people stacked over towards the A site, and nobody's bought an SMG on the Gambit side, maybe losing track of the economy. They will have to go and do their investigations with AKs, which makes them susceptible to being lost. Fortunately for them, there is only one player over towards the B bomb site.
Indeed. So it's going to be quite an easy take. CLG just sitting with everybody by A long. Hey, they went with a gamble, and they came up wrong. So this time around, we're going to be seeing Gambit starting to get some momentum, but I mean, how long do you see this going on? Do you think CLG is just gonna nail it on the first buy? What are we going to see? Because I mean, JDM is going to mix things up.
Well, part of it might come down to utility, because you saw Adren just ran up really B plateau and shot somebody in the head. If he's able to do that again, depending on what CLG have in the bag, maybe their run of success continues. Then again, they just generally look weaker, and the confidence of CLG. They'll have a four-round cushion, so I don't think they're going to be too shaken up. So generally, I think things favor CLG in the long run of Cobblestone.
I mean, at least Waylander's turning up now. Waylander's top fragging for his team. He's got 12 frags, in fact, the most on the server at the moment. So yeah. he's starting to hit his shots a little bit, getting the frags that they need. But and that's made a big difference, too, to the economy. But we're going to see the opportunity to get the buy-in now for Gambit Gaming again. And up straight to Moe. So now this is, Moe's only got 2 kills so far, so he's not really been enabled all that much in these rounds, as Gambit's economy has often been quite stretched. I'm quite curious to see if he's going to be able to get something done finally. He's got the AWP now.
He had the AWP last round as well, but the only AWPs he's had have been the ones stolen from CLG. Speaking of AWPs, JDM has 4 nades and the big green gun. And he is still remaining kind of back to old faithful here for CLG, with JDM going over towards the B bomb site. Playing with the chickens, he will be. We have Tarik and Hayes kind of deep towards mid, towards the A area of things. Not going to have a crossfire though, just solitary holds. Maybe expecting themselves to win their respective duels.
I like that JDM is playing passively now, but you can see that Moe's actually brought himself onto the plateau, and this means that it's all going to be about who gets these opening frags on the plateau push. Is it going to be the CTs getting those defensive kills, or are the likes of Moe with the AWP going to be able to pick off likes of JDM? That's basically what this is going to come down to. The drop zone is going to be now occupied, but Waylander's going to go straight towards A. This is madness right now. He's just going straight for it.
And while he's done that, Dozier has done a great job of holding 2 people towards A. So Waylander was going to take the choke point by a different direction, but he loses the duel. Hayes and Tarik combining to take him down. JDM has announced his position. The pop flash coming in. Adren's going to be avoiding it, but he won't avoid the AWP. Last man standing is Hooch, and JDM is just too hard to stop. Gambit Gaming looking to push the B bombsite with basically no intel, no information, nobody in drop, and JDM says no, no, no.
The strange thing there is that Waylander just goes straight into A. Obviously, you know, he's expecting to have some free kills, but it feels like he kind of really commits so hard into that. Like, he goes down into the slope on middle.
I was watching Dozier on my screen, and he had attention, I think, from both people, from both Tarik and Hayes. So it was quite reasonable for him to do that. It's just that with his jewel, he got shot by both of them at the same time.
Yeah, yeah.
So it was unfortunate. Dozier was going for the rotation. But Waylander didn't even need to push into A. He could have just, in essence, he could have just held connector itself.
Exactly, yeah.
And punished him that way.
Yeah, because he needed the distraction for the teammates on Platz. But, you know, we're going to see another buy coming out from Gambit. Because of losing that round, I mean, it's quite pivotal because now, I mean, well, you know, Dozier's stuck on a Deagle. Mo's already going to get picked off. There's not many grenades to speak of for Gambit, so that means Hooch. They're going to get it done on the shots. And Hooch is in drop, so maybe there's a chance here to do something, but it's like CLG have a lot of players ready to deal with this.
Yeah, you can see Waylander's in a drop as well, and Dozier is rotating as fast as he can because they need the numbers in B. Cutler is starting to wonder what's going on in a drop zone now. Sees Waylander's shoulder, and he's just going to hold more of an acute angle.
Oh, we get a bit of a boost coming in. JDM's going aggressive. Here he is once again. This sniper is pretty fearful, but only one frag for him this time around. And that's going to give an opportunity for Gambit as they bust their way in now. But two players left here. Hooch able to take down two, get a double and allow potentially a plant. Oh no, maybe a little bit too greedy as he gets picked off by Hayes. Not enough cover here. Bomb out in the open. Tarik is going to secure the round there for CLG.
JDM is in William Tell mode at the moment, and it doesn't seem anybody's able to stop him. Top fragging on the server at present with 15 frags. Hayes not far behind him with 10. Waylander second in on server with 12 for 12, but it's not enough. Gambit are 6 rounds behind, and their money is lacking. Few pistols coming out, but they generally need to save some money. Dozier down to 1,600, the rest around 2,000. Although Waylander's opted for a Tech 9 as well, which will bring him in a suboptimal position. Now we've got Tarik holding a similar angle to what we've seen Chris J doing when they were playing Cobblers, although Chris J's was a bit more...
What? What did we... was that like a jumping headshot?
Hello?
What on earth did we just see? What is this madness? Please. Please, Mo. He's now got an AWP.
I've done that.
He's got an AWP out of that. I mean, of course, two of his teammates will die, but Mo's still alive with an AWP. Let's see what he can get. Waylander's charging up middle as well, the Tech 9. Gets a quick kill as well. And unfortunately, Mo is actually going to go down, so can't get anything done with the AWP. But still kind of phased by that that ridiculous shot onto Tarik there. Drenazy looking to get the AWP. Well, this is a little bit of an awkward spot to find yourself in. At least we can hear the... nice ambience of Cobble. Enjoy it.
I'm still recovering, Dan. Give me a minute.
Well, Adrenaline is just taking his time right now. I mean, of course, he's aware that this is essentially what the CTs know is the best possible way to play the end of that round.
Replay,
and
guys.
Nothing he can do.
Don't fail me. I need to see that. That's the most disgusting thing I've seen in 2016. Apart from Fifth Laren's WhatsApp, of course.
Here we go. What? What? What is that? Oh my god.
That is exquisite. That is glorious. Double ops continue on the CLG side. We've got 5 AKs on the Gambit gaming team. Oh, two rounds remain in the first half, and Gambit desperately need them. Many Molotovs on the CLG side, which will be quite the pain should Gambit want to go for a fast play. Adrenaline is charging towards the plateau once again. Can he get more headshots though?
This is looking like a faster pace for the Gambit lads, but can it be a better result? Waylander once again, hopefully he doesn't make the same mistake. This time he doesn't go straight into A. He's going to backstab, and, well, lo and behold, everyone's dead, James.
Everyone's dead, Dan.
It seems like flanking is pretty smart.
It's Hayes and Tarik, the boys, but indeed. They don't. But the money is quite damaged on the CLG side, actually. So, and with 5 players alive, obviously they can't really go for it. But are they willing to go up the tower? When CT save, we don't often see them going up the tower, but indeed, Hayes is going all the way up there.
This is so nostalgic to see people in the tower just...
See? Should have gone up the tower, mate. What you doing down there? Hayes will get a consolation frag in this round. There's actually a maiden tower in Baku, Azerbaijan. And there is an accompanying meal, Dan. Which is very tasty.
I thought you said there's an accompanying maiden.
I didn't go inside, I wouldn't know. CLG down to the last round and down on the money. Might be a mixed bag. They might have to... I was going to say they might have to skip some grenades to share some guns, but I mean, you don't want JDM without the AWP.
No, you do not. So far, he has been somewhat
He's turned his Cadillac van into a monster truck. And he's leaving imprints all over the place of Gambit players. Gambit with a respectable 4 rounds on the board now. Well, maybe not respectable, but it's not a complete disaster, Dan. It's not a complete disaster. We're not on Inferno, it is Cobblestone. Two kits on the CT side. Got the T's just waiting to see if there are any boosts coming in the drop area, but CLG will be wiser than that. JDM with a high progressive position towards A long, and it's going to pay off. Mo has left the building. Now, we've seen JDM rotate before, but he seems content on holding this angle for the time being. Dozier just coming in, firing a cursory bullet, see if there's any response. No response just yet.
Yeah, I mean, a frag like that is going to start to force the hands of Gambit. They're going to actually try to go for a bit of a fake here. They're going to try to pull some rotation, throwing in some nades, taking over control towards plat and drop. Not really going their way, though, but the push is coming into A now. So the two players on the A side are going to have to get something pretty dramatic done, Hooch and Dozier. Of course, as you can see there, Adren is trying to work the drop zone, but he's not really able to get in there in time to stop this rotation. The CT's all over the place. There's five of them still left alive. Oh my goodness, this is rather difficult. For Dozier, three players to deal with, and it's just not going to happen. All five stay alive. 11-4, first half for CLG. That is phenomenal for them.
That is a spiffing half for the American team. Just a quick note. I don't know, towards the end of that round, if you saw JDM basically threw a HE towards Tarek, who was playing very close to the smoke in the mid area. I think it was Tarek, could have been hazed. But you could see the purpose of that was to suggest to the T's that nobody was in that area by throwing a nade. It wasn't close enough to hurt his teammate, but just a small note which I thought was quite smart, especially split-second thinking there from JDM. So, a solid... I mean, to be honest, I'm not surprised remotely by what we're seeing on this map.
I expected
it to be very a far better performance by CLG on this map than the previous, so I think it's very likely that we are going to see a third map here. But only time will tell.
Yeah, I mean, we can see that there's a lot of discomfort for Gambit. I mean, their T sides have been looking a little bit lost. Again, I think it's quite good. We can refer to that Flipside match from Flipside's perspective, what they were doing on the T side when everything was going very well for them. You know, one key thing is that the ability to consistently get a player into drop. That's like equivalent of Mirage consistently getting a player into connector. It's kind of like a fail-safe that always gives you an option either way, either to lurk in slow rotation or to act as a multiple-pronged attack into the bomb site that it's closer to.
Yeah.
And this is something that was a struggle for Gambit. They couldn't remove JDM. They couldn't find a way to stop him having impact by using grenades correctly or taking certain parts of the map away. CLG were able to do everything that they wanted to do, and Gambit definitely looked a little bit less drilled on this map than even Cash. So,
yeah, this I do wonder what they I don't remember what the bans were, but I do wonder what they banned to allow Cobblestone to go through. That said, Wayland has been doing well, but I mean, like, Mo has 3 kills, for example, and we saw how integral he was on the T side of Cash, but now he's on the CT side, should be able to do a bit of what JDM was doing, and he'll need to if they are to get back into this game, Gambit.
And mentioning Mo there and not really being impactful, actually a long time ago, we actually saw this was an issue for Na'Vi, actually trying to find out how can we allow Guardian to do stuff with the AWP on the T side. And you'd often see him not doing very well on the T sides with the AWP, but obviously, it's changed quite dramatically these days. Either way, CLG and Gambit now moving into the second half. Pistol has begun. And do we have a raid boss? Yes, we do. Fugly is the raid boss with the Tech-9 and the Kevlar. And so there's a smoke on Cutler. And I'll have to see where he ends up throwing it eventually. But CLG not committing heavily to anything just yet.
As indicated on your screen, the winner of this series will go on to play Team Liquid, so we could have an all-American standoff, North American standoff, in the stadium, which would be quite fun, but we'll see if CLG are able to get there, or if Gambit will stop them in 2, or perhaps 3 maps. So we've got Mo and Adren playing close to the mid area, as you can see there, just waiting. It's interesting, they're playing pretty close, not wanting to use the range of the USPs, rather wanting to control the map. But we've got 3 plays actually going higher, but the bomb's been left behind. And looking at how close Adrenaline and Mowar, if they choose to push, then things could get super weird, super fast, Dan.
Ooh, let's see. So far, there's a significant lack of oddities. We're going to have the one being picked up by Fugly. He's going to drop it as he is the raid boss. And the push is going to commence onto the B-bomb site.
Look at the rotation, though, from the CTs. It seems that Adren perhaps had the sound cues there, and they're going to have, well, only Waylander in the site itself, but hopefully the CTs will come in thick and fast to help their teammates. Dozy has gone down, as has Haze. Bit of a battle in the drop zone, won by Hooch. The CT's doing great work, and we might not see a bomb plant here. We see headshots all over the place, people getting scalped like it's the 1600s, Dan.
Oh dear, JDM tries to go for the Tech 9 and loses 70 health. That's pretty expensive. And it's like CLG going to lose the pistol round, so Raid Boss getting, well, wrecked there in that round. And Gambit gets to start with a good economy. Although that said, they have to first endure the force buy that is surely coming their way. And indeed it is.
Indeed it is. We have the Tech 9s, the P250s, the pistols, etc., etc. JDM, though.
Ooh, we have a smoke, James.
We have a smoke.
We have a smoke and a flash.
What could this mean, Dan?
I don't know.
What could be the play? They seem to be headed towards the B bomb site, so I wonder if perhaps the smoke could go, for example, between the tree and the statue to make it easier to plot.
Yeah, it's on Cutler. He's actually in the drop zone at the moment. And you have the pop flash into drop zone for the T's. And still the smoke is there for Cutler as they try to burst through the drop, but these SMGs are fantastic.
Denied.
Yeah, UMP. I love the UMP, man. It's so cost-effective. $1,200. That is some really sick bang for your buck.
Yeah, he's just printing paper there. Very nice hold from Gambit. You could hear that they were getting pretty hyped for that as well. That leaves them with a nice bit of money in the hole. CLG not really buying much. Cutler's bought a P250. Other than that, there's nothing going on. So JDM's got 3,400, so he's going straight to the AWP. This man only knows the AWP. So we'll see if CLG can get up to any shenanigans in this round. With four Glocks, I don't expect so. I wonder what Cutler's plan is here. One P250 and four Glocks. I mean, it's a P250 or it's a flash or it's a smoke.
Reminds me of the FPL soundboard. Glocks!
Glocks?
Well, Glocks are coming, man.
Looks like he wants to punish somebody for peeking in the drop zone. Pop flash comes in, but JDM will make use of the smoke that the CTs would have put down. Dozy is standing behind it. He's lost half his health. He's got a UMP as well. No teammate supporting him there, and he's still playing close quarters. There is a player in the drop as well, as you can see. Dozy is finally moving away. JDM gets punished for trespassing, and the T's are rotating towards A, where there is only one player. That's Adren. He's got an MP7. A few more bullets in the UMP. Makes it work so far. Nice three kills for him. All headshots. So, it's Haze. Ooh.
Glocks.
Well, MP7 now. And he is looking for the flank. Can't get the kill onto Mo, though. So, minimal damage done. And we move into the buy, where I expect JDM will be picking up the big green gun. I do wonder how they're going to use JDM with the AWP as well. If they're brazen enough to use him to try and get picks on the platform, or if it'll be initially holding towards long A, as people often do.
Yeah.
But there's rarely an engagement in that situation.
I mean,
and with Gambit four rounds down, I wouldn't expect them to push A long, so I'd probably put JDM somewhere more aggressive.
Yeah, he just needs some help getting into positions, basically. If you can get him all the way onto, like, deep into A long, if you can flash CTs and kill them out of that position, remove them, then you can do stuff there. If you know, even middle from the doors in the middle, you can do stuff, as well as being you know, having your teammates help you out a little bit onto the platform. But I think the B plat is a bit more risky, to be honest. It's hard to know what the CT setups are. The nades can really destroy your health quite quickly. So it looks like we'll be seeing him actually on A long, as you initially said, and it'd be quite cool to see if CLG can indeed get him towards the deeper parts of A long, because then they can really set up, you know, based on if he gets a kill or not, into the A site. So far, you know, we'll get the map, those little map control plays coming in from Canalogic Gaming, but Mo's gonna hamper them slightly. There's the first frag from him, and he's got a teammate Adren to play with as well. So this could be pretty strong, but JDM, that's a great punish there. Mo trying to get out of that position where he's basically stuck in the corner.
Dan, the bomb is miles away right now. someone's going to have to rotate for it, and someone's going to be left alone. Seems Tarek's going to start that rotation, which means all three Ts are completely isolated. No more trade fragging will be done. So perhaps JDM will have to try and hold an angle here. But there are 40 seconds, and that means that they don't really have significant map control. That frag from Tarek will help, but 35 seconds left, and they still don't have the bomb. So what is the play here? Are they going to go for the kills? You can see Tarek's actually rotating to pick up the bomb now, but I mean, they're going to have to gamble on a site here because they don't know where that second CT is, that second CT being Dozier, currently in the connector area. Cutler looking to potentially flank, but the smoke's just gone down. Down goes Cutler as well, but Waylander's left the B bomb, the A bomb site. We've seen this before, Dan, and it's happening again.
Oh no. Anu. This is definitely not optimal. Oh, Waylander catching JDM off guard, and that is going to be very serendipitous because Waylander, you know, should have been punished for that. I mean, you haven't seen the bomb yet. You don't leave James because he had two teammates who were there.
It seems things got awkward in terms of timing again from CLG. We saw it on Cash. We see it again on Cobblestone and Gambit. I mean, life is made easier for them once again, and they're closing the gap. And CLG have lost all their weaponry, all their inventory. It's been raided, Dan, and they're left with Tech9s, a smoke, and this time two flashes. And Fugly's got armor as well. So Tarek, Fugly gone down to 1600, although they're pretty much at max loss bonus here. So let's see what they can do with their slightly upgraded eco round.
Yeah, that Quasi. Let's see, indeed. I mean, there's not really all that much they can do other than try to, you know, head an area quickly, use the numbers and speed of the Tech9s, like the running advantage, the running spread is so good. Can run and gun with extreme effectiveness, and looks like Mo is going to get the first kill there. And as the T's go towards that A bomb site, Tarek actually managing to find himself into the balcony. But these Tech Knights not too reliable in this these huge ranges. That said, it's doing quite a fair amount of damage at this point, but not enough. And actually, four players will survive there. Adren getting his bell rung there, down to 10 HP, but another round there for the CTs, and a rather clean one at that.
Mo's AWP is rescued as well, but look at this, because of CLG's failure. Looking at the money on Gambit, Hooch has $11,000. Apart from Adren, who has just under 4K, Mo has 6K, the rest have 7K and up. So it's going to be an arduous task for CLG to break the Gambit gaming economy in the near future. And that is ominous. And you have to wonder if the pressure will start to pile. CLG five rounds away from victory, but Gambit gaming not too far off. CLG really need this round to be very successful. Ooh, Tarek taking. Oh, 3 days coming in! Could have been a kill there, but it just hit the wrong corner. Otherwise, that could have been a slaughter, an abattoir, Dan, but with no gloves.
Messy stuff indeed. Now, Gambit slowing, or rather, CLG slowing things down a little bit, but they've managed to get into pretty, you know, forward positions while hitting the push multiple times, and they do a good job there. But, oh, JDM forcing Hazed out. Or rather, sorry, Mo forcing JDM out. Unfortunately, not able to get anything, though, with it. Oh, look at that peak straight in the face. Mo is out of this round. And now the T's are going to start streaming into the bomb site. These grenades are doing mad amounts of work at the moment, securing these frags. But Dozier lurking. Dozier can save this round.
He needs a team. He needs a flash from Adren. And here comes the flash. Here's Dozier going to be able to punish, trying to push through the smoke. There's one frag, needs to find a second one. Almost gets Fugly. He does get Fugly. That's a bomb down as well. But there is time to plant it. Dozier's still alive here. How is he still not being taken down? Finally traded by Cutler, but Adren moves onto the site. JDM, of course, who else is driving through these fools and taking the round for CLG?
There's no pit stop for JDM. There's no slowing him down.
But there's no slowing down Gambit either. Straight back on the buy, full buy. They had loads of money in the bank, and they're still going to be able to buy after this round as well.
Yeah. Yeah, Hooch's bank was ridiculous.
I did think Mo's positioning there, I didn't even realize there was a gap in the smoke, but I thought Mo's positioning on the plateau was a bit dangerous because when it was eventually going to disappear, he was basically just out in the open with no cover. So a bit of a risky play there from Gambit, and it cost him the round. CLG potentially going for a fast play straight towards B. I mean, the CTs are going to hear them running all day and they're going to charge in. Have they misread the CT economy or something? They're charging in regardless. Maybe seeing how the flashes worked so well last time. Trade's coming in so far though. Hayes taking that Dozier as well. So advantage CLG, they've got a man in the drop zone. So this might be quite difficult for Gambit. Four versus two. There are two heavily tanked players here for the T side, but that might just shut down the round. Cutler taking down Mo. Let's see, we've got Adren still playing close at the moment. maybe understanding the value of getting a few more frags here. I mean, if they got one more frag quickly, the CT side there, without the second last teammate going down, then maybe they go for it. But Drenz is holding an angle. Again, he could run away to try and save, but he can just hold this angle as well. And he'll have the advantage of someone coming through the door, and then he can try and run afterwards. So different ways to save the gun. You can see CLG not necessarily willing to hunt him down. Nice pop flash there by Cutler, but a bit of a slow peek afterwards.
Oh, there's a frag as well. Is there going to be a refrag? Oh, Cutler. Oh, does get it, barely. Now, Gambit still have money to buy, which is hilarious. Their bank was so healthy. It would have been nice for that, you know, Drone to be able to save that weapon, to be honest, but hey, it won't matter really. Won't affect this round at least. So, Gambit, they're losing a grip on this route, on this this map. I mean, we always expected CLG to win it, but there's definitely some big windows for Gambit to abuse, but those are all closing at this point. And JDM is back on the AWP. He's on 24 frags at the moment, having a pretty big game as expected.
Mo down to a CZ, which is unfortunate for him. And he's still playing with Drent over towards A, but this time they're looking towards long. They smoked it off. And the general watch lower while Mo will play close around the smoke. And here we go. JDM trying to play for picks. But Hooch is going for a play then. It hasn't worked out. Waylander will trade, but it's advantage CLG for sure.
Lots of time to slowly wait. But Tarik, not too interested in that, finds an opportunity. And it turns it into a double kill. And Fugly just going to grab the bomb now and make his way down towards B. This Adren and Mo now in a pretty awful spot, to be honest. Be really nice when Murphy's able to actually pick up a weapon, but from the money perspective, there is nothing left in the bank of Gambit now. They will get... That was savage.
Looking at the way Hooch jumped into B plateau there, I mean, if you look at the way Fnatic were boosting JW up there, for example, it's always in that kind of ninja spot around the corner. So I don't know what the purpose, because there was a smoke down in that position, and I think it's reasonable for the T's to just spray where he jumped there as well. So I don't know why he didn't choose to get boosted at the back, which is relatively safer.
So Gambit will have around, well, between like 2300 and 2800 next round, meaning that they're screwed for money. They can't really buy next round. But that means that before they can buy properly, CLG will be on 15 rounds already. So they're in a really, really bad spot at the moment. Do they force up both rounds, or do they... Or do they just try to get that one big buy when CLG are already on 15? That's the option that they have right now. There are some teams that would say we want two rounds where we have a lower percentage to win rather than just banking everything on one round. It looks like that's going to be the approach here for Gambit as well. So this better go well for them, James, or they are pretty done.
Dan, interesting point. Waylander has FAMAS and no armor.
Yep. So there you go.
Adren, Dozier, and Mo have armor. Perhaps it would be better for him to play one of their pistols and give the rifle to someone who's not going to get aim punched, because he can play a pistol, play close range, and try and get a one tap, as opposed to playing perhaps further range with a rifle and having no armor whatsoever.
Yeah, like even the Mag 7 would be a better choice.
He's going to get cut to ribbons. Indeed, the Mag 7 would be, but Hooch has a Mag 7 and no armor as well.
But hold the phone, we've got Fugly and Haze. They're almost in the A bomb site. What is this? They just walked all the way. They walked all the way.
They're out for a summer stroll in the gardens of Cobblestone.
I think Mo has completely missed this. He's the only guy towards A, and I think he's completely missed this. I think he may have spotted somebody now, but of course he's already dead, so... This and the bomb is going to go down, James. This
easy
is
for CLG. And wait, guess who? Waylander's in front of everybody else with the only rifle they have. And fortunately has backed off with it, so... Oh. Yeah, this is a bit weird.
This is awful, because Cutler just cutting off rotation from B as well. Or basically, their save attempt. So, you know, they're in a ridiculous spot, to be honest. I mean, how many losses in a row is it even?
Dozier's going to boost Waylander, but he still doesn't have any armor. Why is he not swapping the gun?
So they have $2,900 as their bonus for losing the loss bonus. So Gambit, you know, still broke. Would really like to save these weapons that they currently have. And it looks like they should be able to do it, actually. Map point now, though, for CLG. 15-9, and Gambit have not really given them much trouble so far in this map at all. But slightly better buy this time around, thanks to the saves. But will the hopes be better? Will CLG just walk two players into the bomb site again? I would like to see that again, James, because it's quite comical.
Yeah, they were basically going up there on segways. So, this time the entire Gambit side has armor, no AWP. Moe's on the Silence and Ford. The rest of the team will have FAMASes and the Mag 7. Lots of Molotovs on the CLG side. Hopefully they make use of them. So you can see Fugly trying to stop any fast boosts, and Adren going to smoke it immediately. You see if he, and Adren's going to jump up, actually. He's above Fugly, who gets taken down by Waylander. Can he put in any work, though? We've got lots of CLG players going for a fast push. Adren charging through the smoke. Going to get two frags with the CZ. JDM going to try and go for a no-scope, but he's going to get wrecked as well. Adren has just beasted everybody on this map, basically. Finally getting taken down by Cutler, who still has the bomb. He needs to pick it up quickly, though, before that smoke disappears. Cutler versus four. There is a chance for Gambit to survive for now.
There is a chance, but is it, you know, just a delay of the inevitable at this point, considering how strong CLG have been? Cutler could definitely do some serious work if he just gets some kills in. There's another one. In fact, you know, it's still possible with a minute left for him to win this. It'd be a ridiculous clutch. Now, he can sneak into the drop zone. Of course, you know, he's a bit worried about the death cam spotting him dropping immediately, so you know, he waits a little bit before going into the drop.
If you're Gambit, do you stack a site here and then just all rotate together?
Well, the positions are quite good. I mean, they can pretty much eliminate where he is due to the fact they had someone behind him. So they know that he went for a drop. They're just tracking him, but he's
still
1v1s,
though. No trades, that's a problem.
And he can get the bomb down as well. There is surely no way that Cutler pulls this one off. He's going to go for the plant. He's got enough time to pull out his gun, but two players are coming onto his position very fast indeed. Cutler, one versus two, doesn't happen. But the fact that he gets, you know, the extra kills and bomb plants, you can see that. He's just not really all that impressed by this.
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, with the positions Gambit had, they couldn't really all come together. It would be a bit risky. But ideally, perhaps in that situation, you put three people. Because, I mean, at this point, it doesn't matter how much money the T's have. Because they have too much in the bank already. But there we go. Adren just going absolutely ham sandwiches here. All the pork.
It's just one of those things where, like, you know, when you allow a player to like get that much extra done, it just makes the other team feel a bit worse about themselves. And you can see the Gambit definitely in not the best mindset during this cobblestone match. And CLG, they got the AWP back on JDM, a full stock of grenades to work with this time around. And they're opening up the map with a default. JDM watching a long, Taric providing presence for CLG towards B plateau, just to bait out some grenades early on from Gambit. And it's working so far. They are expending some of their stock of grenades. So CLG's early pressure is working out. JDM with the solo push towards A long. Just, well, not necessarily a push, but just a solo hold, let's say. He's now rotating back towards the B side of the map too. So it looks like we will get a B hit coming in. Ooh, Dozy has spotted a player and dropped there. So looks like Gambit knows what's coming.
Yep, Cutler is blind, and there are nades coming in from both sides. CT's deciding to retake the area. Haze is down below. Is he going to be able to trade, though? Dozy is popping out now, and he's going to take down JDM. Waylander going to help him to take down Fugly. And it seems that Gambit are not out of this just yet. Haze alone versus four now. If Gambit can survive with the numbers, then perhaps they can take this to overtime. Down goes Dozy. 35 seconds left on the clock. Haze doesn't have much HP. No nades. And down he goes. So three CTs survive, and now the money will start to be drained from the CLG side. But as they continue to lose rounds, they will continue to build a loss bonus, which will help them going forward. They can get another full buy come in. Bit of a pause, so they just want to... I mean, this might not even be a strategical pause. They might just... Well, I mean, I guess any pause might be strategical, but my point is they might just be using this to break the momentum that Gambit feel they have going. Just make them sit and do nothing for 2 minutes. And then continue the madness.
Yeah, also due to the nature of how they've been shut down. Because I mean, let's be honest. Those in the last couple of rounds that have been won by Gambit, CLG, they didn't really get much done. I mean, they weren't let's say in a position where they had an advantage. They basically were messing up their entries, and the counter flashes from Gambit and so on were providing put to quite strong use. And CLG just got wiped out. They got put in like a 1v4. Twice. So obviously something's going wrong for them there, and they need to make an adjustment. Maybe it's just the fact that Gambit's adaptation is a bit stronger now into the latter part of this half. And that is now a sign that CLG needs to mix it up a little bit. Yeah. We saw that they had a lot of success actually walking towards the A side of the map, and they've been trying to close this match with B takes. So maybe it will be up for an A round now.
Yeah, well, they only have four rounds remaining with which to do it in. And I mean, those are going to be four very precarious rounds for Gambit Gaming, because we all know that it is a very hard site, a map to defend on the CT side. You always feel a little bit stretched, a bit more stretched than you'd like to be, a bit more stretched than you often are on any other map that's in the current map pool. So we will see the buyers come in for CLG. We've got four AKs, an AWP, and we've got the full buy in terms of utility, in terms of nades that we've always seen. You've got five Molotovs, five smokes, loads of flashes, just the one HE onto Cutler. Three kits onto Gambit Gaming, so they probably will be okay there. Well, the timeout is about to disappear, so we'll see if Gambit can hold on and take this to overtime, or if CLG can close this game out and take it to the third map.
Indeed. You know, CLG, they have lost two in a row now, so if they lose this next one, considering that they spent almost all their bank, they need a plant, basically, to get a good buy in the next round. So even if they lose this one, they have to get the plant in. Otherwise, they're going to be in a pretty awful spot. And Gambit will be allowed back into the match and maybe into an overtime situation. But here we go. There's a bunch of rounds before we get there. And we'll get to see what the approach is, what the adaptation is for CLG now. And it looks, you know, somewhat default at the moment. BDM looking to get perhaps an opening onto the B plat, though, with the AWP now, instead of being positioned on A long.
Yeah, you can see. So Hooch trying to jump up again. And as I said, you can see the T's just spamming the positions where that he's trying to get to. And worth noting what Thorin said about the CIS teams being passive. The only aggression we've really seen from them on the CT side is B Plateau trying to get to where Hooch has finally got on his second attempt. Other than that, they're just pretty much waiting for CLG to start and varying their positions a little bit.
But JDM, man, he's right here. He's expecting this play at the end of Plateau. He's scoping in, checking all the spots. Is Hooch going to get caught out? I feel like this is a really big moment. If Hooch kills JDM here, then that completely removes the presence of CLG on Plat. If JDM gets the kill, then he can put the pressure onto the B site, and then rotation happens, and then CLG can hit hard. This is this is basically like the linchpin is Hooch right now. And here goes JDM. Hooch still behind the box. Oh, beautiful flash. And Hooch is going to get the frag. Trying to spray through the smoke here. He's actually missing everything somehow. But the dive comes through from Tarik. He'll get the refrag. And CLG will be able to continue the presence on the platform. And they might just be able to jump off onto the bomb site. All that's not lost yet for CLG. Four versus four, though.
But look at the lack of rotation from Gambit. They've still got Adren and Mo miles away from the B bomb site. And CLG are streaming. And this is going to be a massive problem for Gambit. They've taken down the bomb carrier. And it's going to be hard for CLG to plant the bomb. And they've only got 13 seconds to do it, to plant it. We've been here before. Dozy is covering the angle where they got to plant. They've got time to do it now, and nobody to stop them. He could have just held behind the rock and gone for the shoulder peek, but he's gone for it. And CLG have taken it. Oh, Dozy was just standing out there, loud and proud, in a situation where they have to plant the bomb. I mean, he's going to have to duel at some point, so he's waiting for it to come to him, but he didn't win the duel. That duel would have kept him in the game, but CLG take it, and we are going to go to a third map.
I mean, that was a hero refrag from Tarik. I mean, he went down really low in that frag. I mean, if Hooch gets the instant headshot or something, anything like that, the round is just done. They have to get the instant refrag there, because then they can spill onto the site, and the rotation doesn't get there in time. We see that result. So a really big moment there from CLG to finally clinch that. Like, from watching some of the pulse here, you know, it started to look really, really nervous from some of these players. Like, they were thinking, oh, God, you know, we've got to do it now. This is our chance. We've got to win the match now. Start to see a little bit of jitters, like, you know, and the players kind of trying to flick around and hit the shots. So I hope that CLG, you know, going into the next match map now, Mirage are going to feel a bit more confident, and the jitters will kind of pass a little bit now that they've actually done it. Because that was starting to slip away. Yeah. After starting confident, it started to slip away, and we've all been there.
That first frag from that trio from Tarik was just so big, because if he doesn't take down Dozy there, then they almost certainly lose the round. Again, that clock was ticking, getting pretty red, and the next map will be Mirage. So we're going to throw it to Richard on the desk to see what their thoughts are.
Thanks so much, James and Dan. Fifth Lar, and you're a juvenile. He's just blowing one of them hooters in my ear. Like, unreal. Keep it together, man. Anyway, great cast, great map. And I guess the worrying thing is for CLG is that it was the map. We talked about how Gambit had no experience on Cobblestone, and yet it was still a fight. You know, Gambit were able to put up a lot.
My sound just got a second.
Okay. I think that was a delayed echo from that. I think you blew. Okay,
I'm not talking anymore.
Max is blowing.
The reason why I actually said Gambit to win, or why I had Gambit to win this map, was mainly because of the mentality that CLG players have. losing the first map coming in here. And you saw there at the end of the game, they actually, throughout the first half, they were playing great. And then as soon as the game got a little bit close, Gambit had the upper hand there. Yeah. Managed to finally pull it out in the end. Managed to get Gambit on a save round there as they were trying to climb back into the game. Managed to get a hold of it. And then the last round, you know, it's all on Tarek. They were under, lost JDM at the beginning of the round. And then Tarek picked up the JDM's fallen off and just got some nice kills and ended up the game. And I think without like hero plays like that, things would have been tricky if they ended up losing that round because they were also very starved on money.
And it did sort of fall apart at the end for Gambit after they started mounting a really good comeback, Yanko. So what caused that?
I mean, the problem here is that, you know, yes, they win the pistol, they win the first gun round and so on, but that's where, after that you can see why CLG is a better team on Cobble, because they always have these set strats that they can fall back on, right? These things that they know will work for them time and time again. And at times, it seemed that Gambit's players individually were just off. They weren't comfortable on the map. You could see it more in the first half on the T side, how their timings were off, coordination was off once they were entering the bomb site, and so on. I mean, the upside for them is that finally Waylander had a great game, so maybe that's something they can look forward to coming into map 3.
Yeah, and Duncan, anything to add about this map in particular that stood out for you?
Yeah, I mean, it was obvious that Gambit don't play this map very much. Yeah. Their T-side was particularly poor. I mean, it's not as though they didn't have any frags. Like, I mean, Mo still continued hitting some party piece shots, still looks very good, but they had none of the routine that you need on the T-side. Like, I always say this map, if you're a good team, you should be getting your work done on T-side. I mean, we saw Na'Vi can just straight up win the whole map on the T-side, basically, as they did against Virtus Pro. So Gambit really off on this one, but obviously, with the way the map pool went, they had no choice but to let the guys from CLG pick it. So it was the right pick from CLG because, I mean, when you looked at how close it ended up being, if this had been almost any other map, maybe this would have been a 2-0 for Gambit because they obviously, when they just switched over to CT, then they did have a lot going for them. So closer than I thought it should have been, but CLG survived. That's all that ultimately matters. It's 1-1 now. We each play a best of one to see who gets into the quarterfinals. But I think the key thing for me is the Gambit guys. When, I'm doing a parlor right now. If Gambit was, parlor but why not?
Come back, Duncan.
Okay, so yeah, come back. So coming into the third map now, I actually do think overall, I still feel like overall the fragging is quite impressive on the Gambit side. Like, I feel like they're going to be in the third map no matter what. But I think CLG is getting it together. I still think they're going to win the series 2-1. And I think this was not that convincing on their map, I'll admit. But overall, they could have won 2-0 also. They had their chances on the first map. I think on the third map, they're going to get it. I think they're going to put all the pieces together finally. I don't think it can last that long for Gambit. I think CLG is coming in to take the series.
All right, well, unless you've got anything to add about this map, guys, we'll go to a commercial break. Any thoughts between the two of you?
No, I think we should cut to commercial.
All right, well, I've been told. He does work. He works for Twitch. I've had
whatever
my orders.
Twitch says,
there you go. All right, boss. All right. So anyway, there you go. We are going to go to a commercial break. We're going to be back in 6 minutes where we're going to get into the culmination of this series between CLG and Gambit. Make sure you join us. Hello and welcome back to the CSGO Columbus Major. I'm Richard Lewis, your host, standing in for Scoots while he's getting ready for the stage show tomorrow. And we're in the middle of an amazing series between CLG and Gambit Gaming. Here on the analysis desk, we've got Fiflar and Yanko and Thorin. So we've got one map left. It is effectively a best of one at this point. See who's going to go to the arena. It's going to be Mirage. So how do we see this one going?
For me, I just like looked up Gambit a little bit since they are essentially a new team. If you were to compare to CLG, they actually played Mirage three times, I think, officially, and they won all three. Again, tier three opponents, same thing as Kabul. I think that in terms of experience on this map, CLG obviously has the most of it. But I think in terms of actual firepower, and this is actually where JDM MO will come into play the most, I think, just making sure you lock down the mid area. So I'm still going to stick with my prediction on that Gambit's going to win this game. Mm-hmm. I think it would be fun to have Adren versus Adren in the quarters as well.
It was sad. You were going for Gambit. Sorry, I had a flashback there.
No.
I was thinking back to the three things that I said, which I'm never going to repeat that again. Apparently, those words in Russian are rude. I didn't know that. Now I do. I thought all my friends on matchmaking.
Think about
majors
is learning about other cultures.
Yeah, exactly.
Acceptable in them. So.
Well, you know, yeah.
I'm missing out here.
When you get to work more of them, Duncan, maybe you'll become more tolerant. So, Yanko, your thoughts on this?
I mean, this one is really tricky to predict, in my opinion. Yes, on one hand, you would say that CLG is probably more structured on this map by now, would have better tactics on it and so on. But when you look at the Gambit team, you have players like Adren, Doja, who when they were playing for Hellraisers, it was one of Hellraisers' go-to map, right? And it's a map where Waylander had some crazy performances as well. He's been playing really well on Kobol, the previous map. So I really feel this is a coin toss for this map. But I would have to go for Gambit for some reason in this one.
So people are changing, Duncan.
Okay, I'm sticking with CLG because, yeah. I mean, as for Florence said, this is actually another map where I think the randomizers kind of screwed them over a bit here because they already had Cobblestone, they don't really play much, and they've played Mirage even less. And the thing about Mirage is I've always thought, okay, it's a map, if you're good, you can get a success on both sides, and I know CLG is good on this map. It's the map that originally put them on the figurative map of CSGO, as it were, and really made them a team that were known and were able to upset big teams. So I think actually just the structure, the routine is what's going to get them through this map, even though I agree. Firepower at the moment is on the side of Gambit, so I hope they can make an exciting game.
And also, we need to remember that CLG always disappoints
when
it comes to the majors.
I've been saying that more than anyone else.
Yeah. This is their best chance to make the playoff stage, obviously. So if they don't make it now...
Just retire, probably. Just shut up shop. Kills Cloud9.
Anything to add?
No.
We'll do it.
Let's throw it to the caster. So it is going to be the final map. It's going to be Mirage, CLG, and Gambit Gaming. And, of course, it is going to be James and DDK. Take it away, boys.
I don't know what Thorin was doing at the end there, but he probably needs to be put down at this point. So I do wonder if CLG will be able to take this one over Gambit, obviously having more experience on the map itself. I did want to say before you threw it to the analysts at the end of the previous game that I think this map, we should see the resurgence of Mo. Kobol clearly being a difficult map for him and the entire team, but what kind of impact will he have? We'll have to wait and see. Obviously these players will have played this map on other teams. Maybe they can bring a mix of their experience to put something together. We shall have to see. Gambit will be starting on the CT side, and the number of rounds they get may dictate who should take this map.
Yeah, this is a different beast entirely for me too. CLG, I had them in my mind. Yeah, you know, they're taking Kobol. You know, I always felt like that, but this map feels completely open to me. Now I have to see how things start. We got the pistol coming in to play. CLG obviously starting on the terrorist side and moving the majority of players towards the B apps, the bomb as well. Is it going to be around middle? And we have a bit of a push here from Hooch, actually. He's going to get some info. And I think he spotted a player and he just fell back. I'm not sure if he spotted the bomb, actually. But definitely this could be cause for CLG to take it a little bit slower to see if there's a response from the info. And a bit of a duel coming into play here from Hayes and Hooch. Be careful here not to get popped right at the start of the round.
That can't be favorable for them because that range, they're not going to get one taps on Adren's face. But Adren is going to get a one tap in the reverse. Spots a player in the underpass, and there we go. One tap, but it is eventually returned by JDM. So one man down for either side. A minute 10 on the clock for the T's to do something about it. And they're charging towards the B bomb site. Dozy is there alone. It's going to be a bit of a late rotation for the CTs. They're in the shop now, are two of them, but it's CLG on the sites already. Man bench, two men in the apps and one on the sites.
What are these jumping headshots all about? Dren's going to bust his way through the shop area into the bomb site, and with the help of Waylander, that's JDM dead now, but the bomb is ticking away. Lots of pressure on the T's here, but Dren has no help left at all, and it's going to be Fugly and Taric. Frag a piece to end the rounds, and CLG will actually win the pistol. I mean, they were playing a dangerous game up in middle, I thought, you know, against the USPs, as you mentioned. The USP is very favorable, but they're like, nope, we're going to take those jewels anyway, and somehow we're going to get a frag back. Pretty risky, but they're going to end up the victors. And they've got a couple MAC-10s now, so they can definitely play, they can use those MAC-10s to bust into some positions and aggressively and hopefully play a good anti-force buy. That's what I want to see.
Yeah, they have a boatload of grenades, but just a one Molotov, which has already been dispatched somewhere. I have no idea where.
I think it's been missed, James.
Yeah, it's been missed as well. So, nice.
Nice.
Nice by CLG.
At least they threw
we're seeing good use of Molotov. Yeah, at least they threw it this time. So there we go. JDM in... Ooh, it's going to actually not get naded much at all. Hooch is dead, basically. This is a force from Gambit. We've got Taric towards the palace. Nobody pushing for Gambit. We have three players in B for the CC side. Waylander and CT spawn. So they've got no vision of A. Hazed is behind a smoke in connector, so he won't realize that. The bomb is headed towards the apse, it seems. You have to wonder if Hazed is going to go for a push. He has a MAC-10, so he can go to get some information. Perhaps he can save his team from going straight into the stack. Part of the purpose of these guns is to avoid the stack. They're going straight into the stack, and there we go. We've got a crossfire. They've got... I just don't understand what is going on, Dan. But we can come to that a bit later on. We've got Taric in the back of the apse wondering what he can do. He's going to smoke himself some access to the bomb. Hayes coming in from the shop as well. Waylander playing bench. Mo playing the site. Adren still playing towards the van. They know where both teams are. T's are now. Waylander's not going to win the duel. And Taric should be able to pick up the bomb, but he still hasn't opted to do so.
Yeah, they can still save this round, but what a predicament they put themselves in. Now, Adren and Mo with the CZs can still get something done here, but no ammunition left in Mo. He's got two bullets. He has two bullets. And Taric is going to save the round, but James, that was catastrophic. To be honest,
it's just a mess. I just don't understand what they're doing. Mess. So they bought loads of grenades. They bought loads of flashbangs, loads of smokes.
And this blind going to
one
the site.
Molotov.
Yeah.
They had one Molotov for connector. They messed it up. Then they go towards B with Hazed with a MAC-10 in connector, just standing there. Why is he standing there if he's not trying to find out what's going on? Why are they not willing to risk him dying, going into A to see if anybody's there? Yeah, instead, they have a minute 20 on the clock and they just go into a stack. They deserve to lose that round.
They definitely do. That's not good. CS right there. And
like, does anybody review their demos?
James is mad triggered. I'm usually the one that gets mad triggered by this stuff, but it looks like you're getting the brunt of it now. So this time around, they're going to, after losing so many players, they are going to play a Deagle on Hazed, and James is going to stick with the MAC-10. Taric's going to take control of the connector, though, and hopefully this time they avoid any shenanigans, and thus far that is the case. They're able to get two quick picks as they move into short and connector. Now, you know, they can pretty much trade effectively into any bomb site that they want to. Hopefully they'll use some grenades because they've got two Molotovs to make things even more safe. And that's what it's about. You know, the grenades are about making plays more safe, giving you a high percentage success rate on those plays into certain areas. And you can see Waylander is actually hanging out by the shadow. There's been a bit of distraction there thanks to Hooch. And Waylander's looking for a shot, but he's not going to get it. Trade comes out from Hooch. And oh, what is this? Adren from the back now. He's going to take down Fugly and find himself the AK-47. Oh my god, what is happening? Adren almost sprayed himself his way to another kill, to a third kill there. And that is, in both rounds, CLG lost three players. Their money is going to be definitely hurting after that. It's going to be much lower than it should be.
I can only imagine part of the problem for CLG is that you're only as good as your opponents, right, when you're practicing and so on. So if you can get away with this kind of sloppy play on a day-to-day basis, which you could say they're not because of how bad they're doing in the league they're playing at the moment. I don't know.
This though, look at this. Adren could very realistically get the spray there. One bullet was all he needed to connect. Oh dear. Anyway, 3-0. CLG, despite some interesting rounds, have found themselves a three-round advantage, but they're back up against the buy now of Gambit. Well, for the first time, a proper buy. Although the nades are somewhat lacking and there's no op or mo yet, so this is not going to be the true test. We get some mid control coming in from Hazed. And a defensive smoke there onto short from the CTs. Fugly makes his way up. Good flash going in there. And Fugly's going to toss a nade, an aggressive nade into connector. But I don't know if they know that Mo is there yet. Mo could definitely do some damage here. And he's alone.
Indeed, but he can. Ooh. Oh, that was a very timely flashbang there. Fugly's going to go down. But again, his position is one where he's going to get traded, and he has
that
indeed.
That was a team flash. It almost cost him two players.
I can't. Just move on. So Mo's in a position where he can only get one frag there, and he's been traded, lost position on connector. Now the split is real, but Hooch gets to take down Hayes for free. Again, there's no Molotov in his position, and the A slope players aren't moving fast enough to support Hayes, so he's basically moving into the site alone. And gets punished for doing so. We've got Cutler coming in to connect it now. So CLG have another run at it. They don't know if somebody's short. There isn't anyone short. Dozier starting to rotate away from the B bomb site now as well. And there is JDM coming in, but Cutler gets taken down in isolation with no answer from these two T's who are on the slope. JDM gets taken down just one by one.
That was beautiful.
Lemmings
though.
Off the side of a cliff.
That was really nice because I can't really emphasize enough how important it is for Waylander to stay hidden in that position because he could very easily try to peek for some info onto slope, let's say. They have a suspicion that the T's are coming from there. But you can see we were spectating JDM. He was looking for that entry after using a Molotov on the triple boxes. And this is the team flash. You can see right there getting fugly. And both players, Mo almost gets two kills out of this team flash. When the flash was supposed to be an instant kill for him. But regardless, because they couldn't get Waylander, they had to peek really deep. And then all the CTs can hit them from all angles. It's good A play there from Gambit. And now they're up against some pistols, James. CLG finally being punished.
Yeah. Mo got a free AWP, no less.
Oh, that's always nice, isn't it? The free AWP is quite...
So Dozier's going super aggressive here, but he's putting himself in a position... Well, firstly, they're on an eco, so why is he going so close? He's going to get one tap by the P250! I just don't understand what is going on with these two teams, Dan. And now they've lost the B bomb site because he's given up a rifle, an AK no less.
Yeah, so now it's back to the retake game. Losses, a lot of losses coming in from teams here. I mean, we might see Gambit take this site back, but what is the cost going to be? Definitely too great, even at this point. Waylander taking down JDM. A swift little headshot found there by the M4. And Fugly taking down Mo. Oh, what is this? Tarek comes in from the back. Now Waylander has to clutch versus two players. And somehow CLG are going to reset. They're going to reset Gambit Gaming.
I feel like I'm watching a legendary Eagle Master game, Dan.
This is matchmaking.
I just don't understand. You know they're going to be on the eco, so why is he closing the distance to where they can one-tap you with a pistol when you can play the entire range of apps and you have a man advantage? Why? And you have an AK, not even an M4, you got an AK.
It also means you can't really use your grenades properly either that you've bought. Or your teammates.
It's like, oh, you've made this too easy. Let me give you all the guns back.
Anyway, we've got some pistols brought up by Gambit Gaming now. We've got the Deagle. Two Deagles. A smoke grenade. Let's see how CLG throw this one away. It's their turn now, James.
It is indeed, yeah.
It's their turn to throw it away.
So this time Gambit are on the eco and they're kind of all spread out individually. Seems they can't decide if they want to stack a site or not. It looks like they were going to the way Dozier bought a smoke. Just one nade, bought a smoke, threw it into B apps. I thought they were going to go and stack A. But all the CTs are playing in isolation. And we actually have some Molotovs now from the CT side, which is fantastic. The T side, excuse me. But what is the play? We've got a minute 10 on the clock here, and we've had a number of rounds of CLG have waited too long to actually take a site. We've got two players coming close towards B, Fugly and Hayes in mid as well. So they could do a short split here. There's a smoke in connector, which means they can't be short for the time being from there, and they still have more smokes in the hole. And here comes the push into the B bomb site. So a much safer approach. It seems CLG have perhaps finally learned their lesson. Although we have some kills coming in from the CT side. AK picks up on a drone. We saw what he did last time. This time Hayes has the angle, however.
Indeed. The interesting thing is that they still didn't use any Molotovs to get into the B site. Which is interesting. Anyway, we got... I do have to point out that there is still four grenades on JDM and Tarek. I've got to point that out, James. Considering that JDM was also one of the guys pushing the apps. There's lots of spots on the site that you can monitor easily. Anyway, moving on from that, 5-1 is now the score. CLG in the lead, of course, on the T side. So this is actually a really awful start for Gambit, to be honest. From having to play against five rounds already on CLG side, the 5-8 round range is quite a comfortable scoreline to be in as the T. So Gambit needs to start posting some rounds, and we're going to get a different setup here from CLG. They're looking at basically an A play. Hooch is the only one on the bomb site for Gambit with a Famous and no grenades. The closest teammate to help him out is Waylander on the stairs, who does have full set of grenades. But this will be very tough to hold this push should CLG coordinate in here now, which it looks like they are going to do so.
So Hooch is going to get taken down immediately, as is Waylander. Adren has been a bit of a thorn in the side of CLG. Going to get a frag and rotate towards CT, but they are already a man down. Mo is holding the short angle. Is he going to be able to do anything with that? As you can see, it is not smoked. It is smoked now, so that's going to nullify his position. And you can see Cutler is lurking in the connector area as well, and I don't think Mo's realized that. If he jumps in, he might get hurt. JDM holding an angle, gets flashed just in time for the CT to start advancing, missing the shot as well, and his teammate's going to get taken down. No answer just yet. Finally getting traded. Trades back 2v2. Mo coming in to try and help, picking up an M4 to be a little bit more dynamic. Both players in the CT area looking to try and suggest a defuse, try and draw the T's out, and JDM will have the most perfect timing to finish things off. So 6-1. This score could have been... there could have been like five different scores right now, but it is going to be 6-1 in favor of CLG.
Yeah, Gambit should really actually be ahead, to be honest, or something similar due to the opportunities they had. But hey, you know, it's, you know, this, in high pressure matches, it can really get to some players and teams, and you make mistakes, and we're seeing a lot of misplays, and that's put CLG up. So CLG obviously able to handle things a little bit better than Gambit, it would appear. And there's a mid push coming in from Gambit, just getting some info. Tarixson get a pick as he moves to A slope. And the rest of CLG will be moving towards the B side of the map now. And with that pick and being up against pistols, just need to see the use of grenades here. I mean, to be honest, they could gather group up into JDM's position, which is quite forward in the apps, toss in an ace for the car, for the position at the end of the balcony, and also onto the site and so on, and just get themselves in there. They should be fine now.
See JDM looking towards the left of the van, where it's common. If you jump on the box, that's where you go, straight into his crosshair. Jump on the barrel and you go to the right of the van.
They're being so slow though that they've allowed Gambit to fully rotate to B because they're trying to let JDM get a pick when all they need to do is open with some grenades. And now there's another headshot coming in. Nice tag going in from JDM, but he needs to get the finishes here. Could be in trouble from Dozier if he gets too close to that balcony. And now it's Adren. They're just trying to peek with just JDM versus three pistols. And again, it's happening, James, because they're too stubborn to use the grenades and to move more quickly.
Well, it looks like CLG are going to run towards A, where they have no map control or vision. I mean, at this point, they're gambling because they've played the round poorly and they have no choice but to gamble, because you have to expect that Gambit have stacked the B bomb site. But guess what? Gambit are rotating to A, Dan.
Dozier's picked up an AWP now as well. JDM's AWP.
This is interesting because that means they can't plant on the wrong side of triple, which means they can't plant unless they kill Mo, who's holding CT. And they're going to have 16 seconds, Dan. This could be at least a third round where CLG have not played it properly and lost due to time. Trying to...
Oh my
Six
goodness.
Seconds left, and is the plant going to come in? Fugly is just about going to get it in time. Mo can't stop him from doing it, and just so many frags coming in, down to 1v2. Dozier coming in from short. Fugly and Tarik are heavily tagged. If Dozier can find a rifle, then perhaps he can win the round. And there he is. He's picked up an AK. He's got time to play with it as well. Can he find a head here? Neither T is peeking, but CLG have to be panicking, and it seems Dozier may opt for the save after all. Well, down goes Fugly. He doesn't have a kit, though, so he will settle with that. And I'm not sure what to say at this point, Dan.
So again, just to basically highlight it, when you're playing against pistols, one of the worst things to do is to try to take around really slowly and play for picks, where basically one player can get isolated, because this round is a very good example of that. What you want to be able to do is burst through the choke points onto a bomb site into the open, where the rifles are very strong and the grenades get even stronger. And the way that you do that is by using grenades and coordinating as a team, so you push past the difficult to deal with positions instead of standing in them trying to pick against three players.
What's bizarre is it kind of suggests that CLG have no grasp as to the economic situation of Gambit. Yes, because they're using an AWP on B to try and get an entry while all the guys of AKs are standing behind him.
Also, the other thing as well is that you have a player trying to take information. So if there is a stack, you can sack a player to find that information out, because you have still the advantage with the weapons, because you won't give anything really significant away. So there's lots of ways to play it, but you know, that are good. They just need to sort that out. They need to get that sorted for the future. But we're into a buy versus buy round now. They save themselves at a great cost of their economy, and JDM gets the opener. Trade's coming mid though, but JDM is on point. That's going to be a massive trade now for CLG that into the positive. 4v3. And now they have so much time, they can really just wait it out a little bit and force Gambit to make some rotations and then hit a site together, and Gambit are going to be in a really, really awful spot. But we'll have to see if CLG do get good coordination into, say, site, because they are making a good play now.
Mo keeps getting traded one for one in the connector, and you have to wonder if it's worth it for Gambit. And you have to say no, because they've only got one round on the board out of eight right now, and Hooch is about to get some death from above. Cold steel into the brain. Waylander's heading towards the A bomb site now, but I'm not sure what he is expecting, because they have max loss bonus, but with two rifles alive, well, seems he's not done with this round just yet. And let's see if Fugly or Dozier will win this duel towards the window area. Sorry, the crawl space. Waylander is charging the site, but JDM is just too strong. It's holding this down for CLG, but now Dozier's in CT. Where are they going to plant the bomb? They're going to plant it for short, so Dozier can't do anything about it from that position. One versus three, lots of time on the clock, but JDM again is just shutting them down.
Yeah, this guy is a really good AWPer. Of course, just your AWP skill is obviously can make you a great AWPer, but it's also really great to see, you know, AWPers who are quite strong with you know, a rifle and a pistol as well, so they're going to be, their value is going to be extended over all rounds. But when he's got an AWP in his hands, this guy is just really phenomenal in maps like this. And we can see actually a timeout created here by Gambit. And I mean, to be honest, going down 1-8. Yeah, you know, something needs to be figured out here, especially considering that CLG have been making such big mistakes. The fact that Gambit have only been able to take one round away from that is definitely something that's going wrong.
Yeah, I mean, one of the glaring things for the CT side right now, as I mentioned a little earlier, is that Mo, whether he has an M4 or an AWP, he's playing in connector and he's playing really deep. He has no support. He kills one person and then he gets traded by the T's. And that's not to their advantage. After that, they lose a player. They also lose connector as well. They lose vision of mid. So they're losing so much for it. And you have to wonder where the value is for them, because it's happened at least three times.
Yeah, there's lots of options as well to try to make the AWP useful on this map. Also on across all sites, you know, B-apps short, you know, going, you know, to palace, you know, the taking picks into slope, playing more defensively on connector, and you know, being able to shoot towards palace. There's lots of different setups and so on. It's interesting too, because when we saw when we looked at Cash, Mo played basically the most passive setups possible. Now we're seeing kind of the reverse, where he's just trying to really get in there for those aim battles. And yeah, we can see that it's giving a lot of space to CLG. And it's really nice to actually put a team like CLG in a position where, you know, I mean, this is actually generally a standard that you can apply to, you know, against any team. Let's play like a real default where we don't really give them any peeks, and we see what it takes for them to gain positioning against us. Like how much does it take for resources? Are they good at coordinating? Because if they make those basic mistakes, and you can punish them, if they're doing that pretty well, then that's when you want to get a bit aggressive and start, you know, using your individual skills. And at this point in the CLG, it's hard to really place where they are, because they've been a bit all over the place.
Yeah, I think. You know, they should have been, I mean, they were punished in a sense for their play, but they should have been, their punishment should have been much more severe, Dan. But here we are. It seems Gambit are going to go for the force. We've got Mo going for the AWP. They don't really have, well, it's not really it's a bit, as you would say, a quasi-buy, Dan, because nice. most of the team have two or above 2K. Oh, that's very impressive.
Paint skills.
Allow me to be the first to congratulate you on your illustration. We've got the AWP from Mo and full armor. They've got no nades, though. And the rest of the team have 2K. So you have to wonder what the play is here. You can see that Adren has a far more aggressive position in B apps, and Dozier can run distraction, and Adren can allow two, maybe three players to run past and then try and get some work in with that CZ, should the CLG side go there. But initially they're going to start to take mid. Mo's in connector again. He takes down JDM, but this time he's got Waylander in for support. So you can see they've made an adjustment in the connector area. Now Mo's going to rotate his position. Waylander's still going to hold there.
Interestingly, Haze actually picks up the AWP now, and CLG should, I mean, they probably don't know exactly what the buy is here for Gambit, because Gambit could realistically save, but that's a great kill from Mo, actually. He jumped onto the ticket,
he was on ticket booth, yep,
and was able to get an angle to short to take down Haze. So he's just killed two AWPers, essentially. So Mo's put this team in a really good round here, positioning the round, and Adren with a quick kill onto Color. Color looked like he wasn't really paying attention there.
He was looking at, he was literally staring at the wall, Dan.
Yeah. Maybe expecting a pop flash, it's hard to say.
Yeah, maybe he heard the step and was expecting a flash, so that's quite reasonable. So that's just unfortunate for him.
Mm. Another frag from Mo, he's really putting in the damage in this round. Waylander's picked up an AWP now as well, an AK for Adren. So, wow, big, big round for Gambit, because nobody died, and they picked up three rifles and an AWP. That's a massive swing on value, on resources. Now Gambit just have to not mess anything up. They've got to win five rounds in a row.
Yep.
And now, you know, we shall really get to see what the adjustments are going to be like.
Yeah, they can still make a reasonable half out of this, all things considered.
Yeah.
But they pretty much need to win every single round.
Hooch has been throwing the AWP from Waylander, and he's got the best spawn into Way, so he could attack, jump into Palace if he wants, but he's actually going to play passive on Ticket, it would seem. Whereas Mo is up to his usual tricks on the middle, and it's a passive opener from CLG. They've dropped Bomb and T spawn. They've got a guy in Palace slope, one towards top mid, one on the underpass. So basically everyone in every position.
Yep, so perhaps a different approach from both teams. Doesn't seem that CLG going to be going for a mid take as before. That said, Fugly is in the underpass. And you can see some timing nades coming in from Gambit, but Fugly is playing very passive indeed. JDM has taken down Mo in the window, however. Or actually, JDM's in Palace, so I guess he was towards jungle. And that's changed Waylander's position to, one that's more passive. Perhaps going to pick up the AWP. Indeed, he will. You can see Adren just looking to punish some players once that smoke disappears. We'll see if he gets the timing to do it. They're walking in, one of them looking towards short. So it seems Gambit are positioning themselves, ready to rotate into the A site, but can they get there fast enough?
Yeah, the AWPs are rattling off now, but they're missing their shots, and that cannot happen when you invest in the two AWPs. In the sole defense is the two AWPs, and now everybody's dead. Too much ground was gained there too quickly.
Dan.
With no frags.
Never mind no frags. No CLG player has taken a single point of damage.
Yep.
In that take.
Well, I mean, it was the AWPs.
In that round.
I think maybe three shots were fired from Gambit. And but in that time, CLG had five players on the bomb site. And the funny thing is that they didn't even try to smoke off the AWPs. They just ran past them initially. So see, look at this. Hooch just misses a shot there. These are shots that cannot really be missed if you expect to be able to win this round, of course. So both AWPers missing all their shots. That's not a good sign. 2-9 is the score in favor of CLG. The North American side is looking like they are going to have a very strong result so far in this last map, which will decide who goes through and who is eliminated.
So CLG moving faster towards the bomb site, but the bomb itself is still left towards spawn. You can see JDM's going for a pick, but he's not going to get it. Dozier taking him down there. So that's a big disadvantage. You can see CLG have just been reduced to basically playing for picks. Like JDM, find us a pick that we can play on a bit later on in the round, but it hasn't happened on this occasion. That said, they still have a 7-round lead. Moving into mid, but again, at some point, someone's going to go and have to collect that bomb. And if you're a CLG fan, you might start to get worried about their timing should they not get a pick soon.
We saw this kind of a play before from CLG, kind of smoking up deep into the connector. But they never actually clear connector. The last time they tried, they got team flash. And you can see that that's going to be a problem because they smoke deep connector. But you can only do that if you have a guy who's cleared it. Because as we saw now, a CT has gotten a frag and spotted the info. Now Dozier gets the peek onto Haze, finishing him off. And this split is just completely decimated and staggered. The coordination is brutally destroyed at this point. Cutler is in on a frag though for Dozier, but he's all that's left. Nice little spray down onto Adren. Oh, the damage is
1v1,
absolutely
1v1.
Phenomenal. Cutler, he has to go for the ace in this situation to win the round now at this point. Already with three frags, he will go for the bomb plant. Two players in shop, I think he knows it as well. Oh, goes for the peak, trying to catch somebody jumping through the window. Big gamble, but he knew he had to get more one versus ones. And rounds is won by Gambit.
Looking at the economy of the CT side, Gambit can't really afford to have so many players taken down, bearing in mind the deficit as well. They had, what was that, four versus one?
Yeah, more or less.
And they opted to just try and stop the plant from going down, essentially, yep. Rather than using the numbers advantage and ideally surviving with more players getting a trade in a 2v1 situation.
Discipline,
at
man.
Least. So maybe it may be nerves kicking in, I don't know. But now CLG moving quickly over towards the A sites. A buy on both teams. We'll see. There is a smoke down towards A slope. They're not opting to play somebody close to it, as you might see Luminosity do with Fur. But they have Hooch in the shadow position. And now we're seeing the Molotovs come out from CLG to force him from it. But the flash came in at a good time. And Hooch is going to push. And he should get Fugly down. Indeed, he will. So now they've got the high ground over the three lower players here for A on CLG.
Yeah, that's a really good push there from Hooch. He's done a great amount of damage here. Now the rest of the players from CLG trying to funnel in through the slope. But it's not really working out. As we have the hold from Waylander with that AK-47. Attack with a frag back. But it's maybe not really going to be good enough. As well, now it's just two players there for CLG. JDM trying to kind of re-clear this palace area as Tarik just sends out the feelers up on slope. But really, not much to really do as the CTs have the bomb in the open. JDM will try to open things up from palace, but It would be criminal if COG are allowed to win this round from this position.
Well, we've seen many crimes already, Dan.
That's true, yeah.
Why not add another one? We'll see if Gambit Gaming are holding pretty passively. JDM is just searching for a pick, but he's not going to find it. And we are going to see the AWP continue into the next round here for Gambit Gaming. So can they get a 9-6 on the board? CLG's money is in a difficult situation now, but it's ranging between $2,000 to $3,000. Cutlass picked up a P250 and a smoke. Nothing else really doing yet. You can see Hooch just hunting, and he will find.
Yeah, that's a really smart play from Hooch, to be honest. Going aggressive in that spot can really catch players off guard, thinking that they're safe when they're not. And now we're going to get a fast play with the pistols into the B apps and middle, looking perhaps to get up up short and into B. Let's have a look and see how it pans out. In fact, are they going underpass? It looks like they may instead be going underpass. Or maybe not.
Fugly's in the apps, trying to avoid a bit of grenade. Tarek's in the underpass. They've got two top mid. Cutler's nice. Also in the apps, so we'll see what the play is. Cutler's moving forward to join Fugly, but he's getting smoked. And it seems that Gambit not going to sit on their laurels. Going to go for the hunt. Edren's going to use this smoke to find out what's going on. Sees JDM going towards Connector. Takes him down as well, but there's two lost for the CT side.
Interesting. Three versus three now, and Haze has actually claimed the AK. Of course, there's no Kevlar on these players, and Haze has picked up a smoke as well. So this is there's some work to be done here for sure for CLG if they get a trade into some good positions. Some nice shots, they might be able to accomplish something now. And Gambit, they don't know where on earth CLG could be going, and that's also going to be playing in the favor of CLG as they approach one of the two bomb sites. This time it's going to be A. Fortunately, Hooch has a really good position, to be honest. He can play this really safe. He doesn't have to die. He doesn't have to face and die, I mean. He can buy time for his teammates to rotate safely, hopefully, for him.
Well, yeah, Hooch is holding super passive towards CT, but CLG have to imagine that somebody is somewhere, so maybe they're going to look. Dozier could run distraction because he's going to see Cutler from jungle. Cutler going for the smoke plant, and it looks like he's going to make it as well. Done. Dozier will get the frag, but Cutler will have some much-needed money for his team going into the next round. So there's a man advantage for the CTs. Haze has an AK-47. Fugly spotting the player, and now the two Terrors are trapped. There is a kit onto Adren. Down goes Hooch to AK, coming into work. Can they take down Dozier, though? Dozier hears the jumping, but he gets both the frags, and that's another round on the board for Gambit. So they are going to give themselves a fighting chance going into the second half, and judging by the first, it's surely anyone's game.
Absolutely. It's very impossible to call at this stage, especially considering how fragile the economy can be. I mean, let's just imagine a world where JDM can't really afford the AWP, or his team is put in this position, you know, where the money is always very low. Could end up really swinging in Gambit's favor if they get momentum. We've seen that the pressure has started to affect them. We saw some disappointed looks from the players in the previous map, and we've seen some errors of discipline, which usually happens when the pressure is really, really on. So 5-9, last round of the first half of the last map in this best of three. And JDM with the AWP, as well as Mo. Mo has gone to middle as usual from Connector. He's been there often.
JDM's going for the B pick again, but the Molotov has stopped his timing. So we'll come back to that a bit later. We've got duels going on towards the A site. Trade's coming in, but CLG not in a position to capitalize on it, really, because they are quite spread out. Fugly heavily tagged as well. I was going to say, with a fast timing, JDM can perhaps try and get CT to jump onto the box, but then Molotov will put a stop to that. Haze goes down as well, so CLG are quite handicapped here. They will need JDM to drive them into the next half. Molotov going out, trying to force anyone from the position, but there's nobody holding there, and that will give a bit of a warning to Gambit. Dozier's in a position where it's going to be hard for JDM to pre-fire him, but it is JDM after all. Almost gets the trigger off there, but he gets punished. Shot straight to the head. Down goes Cutler as well. Fugly potentially soon to follow. Gets a bit of a dink in there, but it's 4-1.
Yeah, big problem here. I mean, they can't really make their way out of apps, and the grenades this time actually kind of gave away their position. And this is so difficult to deal with. Surely Fugly is not long for this world. CLG still with 9 rounds, though, so even if they do lose this one, we're in a pretty damn good spot going into the next half. Fugly looking for a quick kill and going to try to smoke his way out of this one, but three CTs on the angle, so the one is actually quite far away, but Fugly with 10 HP is definitely really out of luck. Dozier with the frag. 9-6 in favor of CLG. A very strange first half on this deciding map of Mirage here at the Major Columbus.
Indeed, it's. I expected CLG to be more coordinated because they definitely made a mess of many situations in that half. And Gambit have got themselves to a score where they can definitely. They're definitely not out of this. I mean, it looked pretty bad.
Yeah.
At the beginning when it was 7-1, and then they made it 7-2, and then they got reset. Yeah, on their economy again.
You can never count a team out even when they're at a disadvantage just because how we've seen the advantages being played. Like it can be quite random, can't it? It's hard to count anyone out at this point.
Looking at the way those rounds went, you could have put 10 different scores in a tombola and just won, spun one out and awarded it to either team there. But it's going to be Gambit with a deficit going into the second half. So we'll have to see. Again, JDM has been key for his team, as per usual, 15 frags on the board for CLG. And I think he's going to be the key man to stop here. I mean, CLG did a good job of taking mid and then didn't do a good job with connector, missing multiple nades, just simple nades going into the connector itself, team flashing their team and so on, not checking it was clear, having the smoke deep connector and just assuming that nobody's there and going on their merry way into short, etc.
That kind of stuff is if I mean, basically, you know, not crossing your T's and dotting your I's sort of thing is, it feels like in that
shortcuts.
Spot. Yeah, they're taking shortcuts, but it also feels like, you know, why are you doing these things if you're not going to actually do them properly? Because obviously, you know, with the connector example is a really good one because there's two ways to smoke it. You can obviously smoke close so that the CTs can't see it through at all, or you can smoke in deeper, which applies more pressure to the CTs because they can't look into connector and they have to flash their way in, and it means that there can always be a T in there, which that's like the dangerous one. And obviously, if you're not going to go in and actually clear connector, then you throw the smoke that's closer. It's a little bit worse for you, but you throw it because you don't want to actually spend that time doing that. So it's like, you know, you've got to do it properly. We're seeing these shortcuts take place. So definitely they're scrambling a little bit in some of these rounds. So, I mean, Gambit, they might have a lot of tight executes on this map that might break CLG. It's hard to say. I haven't seen Gambit play Mirage in quite some time, so...
Yeah. I mean, they haven't played it that much, as they said on the desk, as this team. But obviously, they've played it in other teams. Jonan Dozier having played it with... I mean, Mo was in Hellraisers as well. So, it's, you know, they can string some Hellraiser strats together, perhaps. We'll have to see how it goes. The bomb's been left in T-spawn for the moment, and they're going for the jewels in mid. But even with a P250, I don't think you're going to get a one-shot. The damage fall-off is too great there, so it's very disadvantageous. And they've paid for it. Adren's down.
Indeed. So this is, you want to close the distance with those Glocks. And they are very spread out right now. Trades are not even really possible if they find themselves in fights. But they are moving towards the A bomb site. And Dozier can attempt to take control of connector, but with no smokes, he's going to likely be in a disadvantageous engagement against Tarek there on short. And he might get shot in the back of the head if he's not careful. He's trying to take both, but now Tarek spotted him. He's going to make the call as well to his teammates. And that's going to be a big tell also as to what's happening. Now here go the grenades, and Tarek's going to move forwards, knowing Dozier's in this position. Dozier pinned down. He can't get the kill against Tarek. Oh, that's a money nade right in there. 4 HP left on Cutler, but there's nobody left to kill any of the weak players. Gambit there, that's definitely quite a convoluted round that didn't pay off for them.
Yeah, it seemed they wanted to go for basically an ace split through mid, but it's the pistol, and they were looking for the jewels top mid.
Yeah, that's
the weird
one. As
opposed to, for example, moving to the box, etc., but then that can cause more problems of a guy coming out from short. So I think you need to invest in a smoke and get it into the window if you're going to do that. I mean, maybe they had a guy underpass. Maybe he buys the smoke and puts the smoke there or something. But whatever their plan was, it didn't pay off for them. And that was a great opportunity for them to even things up really, really quickly. But they've gone for the fourth, which may prove more promising for them. Three people top mid, and there is a rifle caught out of position. Hayes, is he going to get traded? He is indeed. No answer, because we've got a smoke into CPL this time. And there's a smoke on short, which means Moe's going to pick up an M4, and he has armor. That's not a good start for the CTs, despite taking down Waylander.
Yeah, aggressive stuff, and Hooch basically forfeited having anything in favor of having a bunch of grenades. And he's still got a Molotov on him as well. So this is really nice to see from Gambit in this force buy situation. And now the tables have not necessarily turned completely, but Gambit have a more legitimate chance in this round now that they picked up an M4-2 onto Adren, who has the most health with armor also and head armor too. So Adren looking to potentially lead the charge.
Interestingly, neither team has basically any information at the moment. CLG not peaking mid, Gambit are all together. They've got nobody towards A, so they don't know if the CTs are pushing them, but they have to. I think it's a reasonable assumption they wouldn't be in this situation, because more isolation might be quite risky. But there we go. Adren coming into mid, and it seems that we're having more people move into the underpass here. Fugly trying to look towards short and towards Palace because of the lack of information.
Now, this is a very good move, isn't it? Getting Hooch into the window, and because it's actually clear, this gamble is going to pay off massively because he'll be able to catch off the rotation now. I love that they've spent the time to invest in getting Hooch here, but there's a very significant lack of time, 20 seconds to plant the bomb now. They've got to really get their skates on at this point. Hooch goes for the peak, maybe a little bit too prematurely, and now they discovered his position. There's no time to plant the bomb. And it just they just needed more time to pull something off there. And Gambit, it was a nice idea, but it didn't work out for them. So 11-6 now, the score line in favor of CLG. North American squad now is going to be reinforcing their arsenal with superior weaponry, although the scout is still on JDM, but at least they have utility.
So you can see some frags from Tarek there, just putting a stop to the shenanigans from the Gambit side. They had a window of opportunity, but it was quickly shut once they try to go through it, quite literally. Five rounds ahead are the CLG side, so things do bode well, and it's going to be a long road to victory for Gambit. They don't really have any investment into this round, and they are going to get picked off fairly easily. JDM's going to get dinked, but the rest of his team can... Well, he's still going for the peaks, actually, but the rest of his team can clean things up for him. Three players remaining for Gambit, all heavily tagged. Still in control of the bomb. You can see Dozier holding an angle top mid, but there's not really much for him to be done there. He has a P250, so he could finish off JDM or sit there and try to punish a rotation. But all the remaining Ts are quite spread out. JDM taking down Hooch, so the last two, see where they are going. Adrenaline the other pass, Dozier top mid. JDM rotating to CT, so CLG are going to put two per site now and try to stop the plant, try to not allow that economy to come in. Tarek on the high ground, boosted onto the bricks on short. We'll get a important frag. That's a bomb down, and he'll finish things off. So CLG double their score against Gambit, and the light at the end of the tunnel is slipping away for the CIS team.
Yeah, absolutely. Now Gambit, though, they will have AK-47s. So if there was a time to actually see an execute from them, I think like on A or something, I think that would be interesting. I mean, also, you know, something that could work out for them, considering that JDM's still on a scout, is something like a contact play, just a fast contact play into A or into middle, something of that nature, just a fast play, can also, you know, work out. But Gambit going with a slow approach and playing a default, splitting up pretty much, again, you know, into every position onto the map that's uncontested for the T side. Getting a player into underpass, so it does look like they're going to set up for the A split. Get a bit of an altercation here in middle, and JDM is ultimately smoked off, but not before getting Dozier down to 9 HP, and Waylander also taking some hits. So, bomb still down in T spawn is also something to note, but if they are truly going for the A hit, Hooch on slope could go back for that, but with Cutler in this in a position right close to Hooch, it could be quite problematic.
Yeah, we see Cutler playing a much more aggressive position than Gambit were doing, and I think Gambit could have potentially benefited from being a bit more aggressive. So Hayes going for a flash peek, but not finding anybody in connector. There are two places for Mo to look, and he's going to get punished from being in the wrong place at the wrong time. Man advantage for the CT side. Some players heavily tagged, but there's an important smoke down, but JDM's going to take down Waylander, and Hooch is soon to follow. Dozier has less than 10 HP, and going to do a bit of damage to the CT side. He's got 40 seconds left, so he's going to go for rotation. We'll see if he can get there fast enough. There's nobody on the B bomb site right now for CLG. We'll see if they choose to stick together or if they will eventually start to rotate. They seem convinced that it seems to be A. Tarek only now starting to rotate. Dozier, if he just goes all the way, he might be able to get there in time. Tarek jumping onto short through CPL, actually, so he might be able to stop this. Dozier slowing down now. Don't know if he saw Tarek, but oh well, he saw the Molotov, so he knows what's going on. That's going to stop him being able to plant anywhere but exposed to short. 10 seconds remaining now, and he has to go for it, but Tarek is going to stop him in his tracks. An important round for CLG. That's the buy from Gambit broken.
Yeah, good attempt at a plant there from Dozier. I mean, a plant actually would have allowed them to buy this round, although it would have been a bit sparse. It could have happened, and it's often worth it to, you know, in this position, get a buy-in like that, obviously, because if you then get a bomb down and this round, then you can buy in the next round, and so on and so forth. But anyway, the pause does come in, and there are a lot of things to discuss here for Gambit. of course, again, they can't get the full buy in this round. They have to wait one for that. But what is the main adjustment going to be for them? Because so far, CLG have been doing a pretty good job when you know, Gambit have really spread out. And most of their plays have come from that. They spread very thin. And the problem with that is that it's harder to play trades. It's harder to, you know, flash one another, get the smokes into the right position so you can guarantee that you take certain spots. Some teams like to get, you know, three players or more in middle to basically embed somebody in connector, like really make sure that guy gets in connector. And then you'll see like two of them then go all the way back around T-spawn into slope to then do the A hit and just leave that guy there forever, basically. And, you know, it's, you know, it depends how you want to play it. But it looks like there's an unpause. And the game is underway once more, and we'll get to see soon what Gambit decide is the way to win this game, because it's soon slipping out of their grasp.
Gambit have gone for the half buy. They have 1 to 2k left in the bank. You can see a lot of armor. Mo is going for the savers. He will want the AWP, but looks like they've got an execute in mind, because we've got three smokes, a bunch of nades. Trying to punish JDM for being a little bit too cheeky. Oh, missing an important shot there as JDM, and it seems that the split is on, but they're rotating away from the A bomb site, but they don't have anybody to get into B fast enough. So I don't know what the plan is. Hooch was running away from A, and now he's going back towards A, and now he's walking backwards away from A again. Dozier is in connector, so maybe he can try and punish some kind of rotation, but they don't really have any advantages towards B because they had nobody there. Now Mo's going fishing with a P250. So the uncertainty they may end up paying for. JDM taking down a Dren. Now we've got two people over towards the B bomb site, namely JDM. No one else required. If Dozer can get a pick here, no, he can't. So Hooch is all alone. The moment of hesitation.
Yeah, when they decided that they were going to go B instead, Haze pushed the slope. Haze went for the manly play, the real man play, and pushed slope, which almost immediately in that position confirmed that it was going to be a B play. So they immediately knew what was going on. They had three players there pretty much. So 14-6, and now we'll get to see the fruits of that timeout, and hopefully the fruits are not rotten, James, because they won't have really any more chances than this.
So we've got five AKs, no AWP for Mo, unfortunately for him.
Oh, do we get an execute finally? Looks like we might actually, but the two are in Palace. Dren might be able to smoke jungle from top mid though. That could be what his plan is. No, he's actually going to re-smoke the middle window, CPL, and his teammates are pushing up, and actually they'll be rewarded getting the entries they need to start to work on the A bomb site, but they're still not in, and JDM's not smoked off. And he's going to get the pick on Waylander because of it. Tarik able to spray through the smoke, not quite finding the kill on the planter. The bomb goes down. 2-3 now in favor of CLG on the retake.
Adren is coming in from the underpass because the bomb is planted for connector, but CLG must know that this is an option. There is a smoke on one of their CT players. Adren now trying to battle with JDM, but rather him than me. Down to a 2-2 now. Hooch is still in a position to do something about it. Down goes Tarik, down goes JDM. Gambit take the round, pick up the AWP for Mo, but their score is still half that of CLG.
This is a really tough spot. There's no denying it. You can see that the elation there when they won that round. Hooch winning some very important one-on-ones. And now there is another chance. Well, there are more chances for Gambit to bring things back and to break the bank potentially of CLG. If they win this round, CLG won't be able to really buy. So they could start stringing some momentum and hopefully confidence together. And looking to try to get Mo up on middle. Smoke for Catwalk. Mo on the boxes here. Can he find a pick? Yes, there it is. JDM taking one straight to the dome. Now Mo looking for more. Will he be granted more? Tarik is there by the short area. If he goes for the peak to chair, he is a dead man. He feels it as well, but Haze might get himself a frag here. There goes the pop flash. And is it going to be good? Looks like it is. Waylander is going to go down. And now it's a 4-4, but at least Dozier's in connector, and the A play for Gambit is still on.
Yeah, but we've seen the rotation from Tarik towards A. Maybe the two deep CLG plays feeling a bit vulnerable, but now Tarik rotating back towards the B bomb site after they take that kill in Palace. But Hooch has taken the place of his fallen teammate, and we've got two players coming in on A slope. Dozier's been waiting in connector all this time, which means they've got some good angles on the CTs here. Nobody in jungle as well, but they'll have to be paranoid about it with the Gambit Gaming side. So can they be successful here? Looking away from the flashbang, Hayes doesn't get anything in shadow, leaving his teammate Cutler in CT waiting for the retake. Fugly and Tarek streaming in, but can they get there fast enough?
That's the question. The bomb goes down, and Cutler is the one by CT spawn. Fugly coming up from connector. So they are going to have some coordination into this one, but they're going to have to hit some phenomenal shots here. There's still some nades left on Gambit. Fugly trying to peer over the top of stairs. He's going to be rewarded. Adrenaline is going to go down. Now Fugly is going to try to take some more damage here. Tarek with the support there by Jungles, clearing a space. Oh my goodness, Fugly with another one. Now Hooch has to get it done. One versus two. Again, Hooch put in these positions. He's going to find one frag. Still one more to go as Cutler tries to play the bomb. He's going for the hold. He's done it! 15 rounds now for CLG. Hooch, he's been played for a fool. And that is going to be match points. One more is all it takes for CLG to secure that spot in the arena, in the playoffs of the MLG Major.
I think the death knell may have been rung for Gambit, but they have another buy thanks to that plant. Mo will be the only person lacking a rifle here. Tarek, I don't know why. I mean, Dozier's position just was a bit poor there to be able to be shot in the back. So that was a bit of a mess from Gambit, unfortunately. So last chance saloon for eight rounds.
Look at Tarek. Look at Tarek's position there in the smoke. My goodness. That is the cheekiest thing I've seen today. Just look at this. Beautiful. He's still in the smoke and now he's going to emerge. Loud and proud, taking down Mo, and three versus four now as Hooch is going to get another frag. Hooch has really been delivering in a lot of tight spots, but it just doesn't seem like enough at this point. Dozier is the only man who's going to be able to support him. Hooch stuck on top mid at the moment. Dozier's going to pick up the bomb. But James, they are two versus four, and this is the last chance.
This means that they're going to be facing Liquid in the Nationwide Arena, should they get these two final frags, Dan. This is going to be America versus America, stars and stripes all over the place, Dan. We're going to see plates, children, everything. It's going to be crazy. Dozier and Hooch, what do they do in this situation? Look at Cutler's position on A. A is currently unplantable with the crossfire that JDM and Cutler have. Hayes is holding a passive angle towards CPL, so there's no funny business. And Fugly needs to watch short and the apps, and short is where these final Ts may be headed. Spending a lot of time exposed to connector, but the CTs aren't going to peak. I'm not sure if Fugly has heard anything just yet. Pretty sure he hasn't because he's still looking towards the window. But now he hears the running. Dozier's going to snap his face off. 20 seconds to plant the bomb. And Hayes is in position, trying to make it a 1v1. But indeed, it will be a 2v2 retake for the CTs.
Hooch has really come alive in these last rounds to really keep his team in it. But will they be in it to win it? It's a million-dollar question as Cutler comes up from the B apps. And JDM lurks in shop, making a lot of noise and switching up for a more dynamic option, the rifle. Cutler in from the back now, and that's Dozier done. Once again, it rests on Hooch to keep the chances alive for Gambit. As JDM and Cutler make their way on, trying to support one another. They don't know where Hooch is. He's got the perfect position. That's one player down. Bomb is ticking away. There's no time for Cutler to do this. Hooch will re-emerge. But unfortunately, he has done enough. And Cutler cannot get it done. CLG, they still have to fight against Gambit. Gambit not giving in. Not just yet.
Seems they didn't consider the bench position on that post-plant situation. And that gives Gambit some breathing life. But there's no... Some breathing room, excuse me, but there's no cheers, there's no whooping from Gambit anymore. They are pretty quiet over there.
You have to really just marvel at the fact that they won that 2v4 with all the pressure, knowing that round eliminates their team. That's a pretty sick job in that round by Hooch and Dozier. Oh, once again the shenanigans. The short shenanigans from Tarek, he's doing exactly the same thing.
We have seen teams spray that smoke.
In
previous matches, but it seems that, I don't know, perhaps they haven't even figured it out yet because Tarek's going to get another frag flanking Adren, but there's no rifle to pick up.
He actually has armor as well, so he definitely was confident in that play.
Well, the bomb's gone down, completely exposed to shorts, and we'll see what CLG choose to do. If they choose to go for the retake or choose to find some exits, try and steal some weapons away. Their economy has been ruined, been tarnished, been demolished. by the T side. And you can see Hooch is not going to be escaping this way anytime soon. JDM has a very good chance of taking this rifle here. Oh, he's going to get there to finish him off and pick up a nice prize. There we go, more frags coming in from the CT side. The T's can't even afford to lose all these weapons, to be honest, and it's only Dozier alive now, and I don't know if he's got the HP to survive in this angle. Cutler trying to finish him off, and indeed he will. So all the T's go down, despite winning the round. And their money will range from 3.5k to 4.5k. So for the most part, they're going to have AKs, but they're not going to have the nades.
This is so tough. What a test of mental fortitude to emerge with an overtime result in their position, knowing that you can't make a single mistake. As if it costs you the round, that's it, you're done. And Gambit, you know, being elevated to legendary status would be obviously so significant, being a qualified team. So here we go. JDM will make his way into the palace with that 5-7. But there are three players. Surprise! And Dozier will get the refrag. And it's going to be four players still left alive here from Gambit making their way in. The Deke cannot get it done. But maybe Cutler can with the AK. There's one frag from below. How much more can he get here before he gets spammed down? And it's going to be Mo, it seems, that will be able to clear him out. Just fucking left now. So it looks like Gambit will hold on again.
Well, Waylander's been dinked. So there's still some work to do. Fugly's got nothing to lose here. He's just rocking with a P250, so he might as well go in and do as much damage as possible. They're trying to peek him with more than one person at a time, but he's found it one versus one with Modem. Molotov coming in. He's going to back off and get sprayed down by Adren. Gambit continue to survive. Two players remaining for them, which means still their money's going to be super, super tight. We'll see if they can break CLG once more, who are coming back on the buy, including the AWP with JDM, to which right now Gambit have no answer. No AWP on
Mode. I mean, Gambit can be coming into a little bit more confidence, just a little bit. And COG, you know, that gets to a point where some teams get frustrated and they start getting in their head, even though it just takes one round. If they get in their head enough and start questioning things and lose what got them to that point in the first place, we could legitimately see Gambit take advantage of a spot like that. But here we go. We've got a fast play from Gambit making their way up short now. We haven't really seen such pace before, but Tarek's position, he's been mixing it up, and it is really solid this time. 3 versus 5, and Gambit are looking really, really in dire straits at this point.
We see the smoke from Waylander from Teethborn into CPL, which may have helped them on the pistol round, but that's a long time ago now. So severely handicapped are Gambit Gaming. Again, they are against many match points. Hayes and Cutler playing their strong positions once again, and those nades, the few nades on the Gambit side will give their intentions away. Hayes going for the pop flashes again. He's got Cutler in for support as well. But Adren's coming in through connector, which might be a bit of a problem. Down goes Hayes, but in a trade, 3 versus 2. Adren, though, he's got two people coming towards him, jungle and connector. Takes down Tarek, but will he be ready for jungle? He's the last man standing for his team now. The Clutch King with 100 ping. The bomb is not in his control. And who better than JDM to finish it off and send his team to the Nationwide Arena?
Now we're looking at Legends, as CLG make their way to that playoff spot. And as you said, against North Americans, I'm not sure. I mean, we've never seen that before, I don't think, and I don't think we'll ever see that again, potentially. You know, who knows how the future will pan out. But that's definitely going to be quite the rare occurrence where the brackets have all panned out, thanks to that Liquid victory over Fnatic. But Gambit,
best of one, baby.
What a roller coaster Gambit has been through, you know, to qualify for this tournament, being a newer team, a newer squad. I'm sure that there's a lot for them to learn from this experience.
Well, there's a lot for CLG to learn from demo as well. And the thing is, bearing in mind they still have teams to play, still teams coming up, Liquid are going to be watching that closely. They're going to be like, "Yep, Mirage looks good."
Yeah. Oh yeah. I mean, some of these rounds have been pretty atrocious, and CLG need to fix that. And I'm sure that they're going to. They as CS players are going to realize this. So they'll feel it. Hopefully, as you say, they'll check the demo and they'll apply the fixes, to be honest, because there are some simple fixes to some of that stuff. So hopefully you'll see a stronger CLG. And the other thing with CLG is that they're going to be up against not a Gambit, a team from a completely different region that they've never played before, even a new team. They're going to play, you know, it's going to be a domestic matchup. Domestic matchups, they can often prove to be quite weird and interesting, because the domestic regions have their own meta games of their own. So you're in a spot where you can ignore certain things that you need to do in other matchups, and because it's that specific team that you know how to play them.
Yeah.
So who knows what happened there?
Another question is, because it's a domestic matchup, you have to wonder if they'll get away with more of that, or if Liquid will punish it for them. I mean, Adren's playing out of his mind at the moment. Obviously, they've got Simple on the team, which is always going to be a problem, and quite a challenge for JDM. Again, let's not forget, CLG have been performing pretty awfully in the ESL League, Pro League, whatever. So we've got Prakit with Tarek downstairs for a post-match interview. Over to you, Chris.
Thank you, guys. Our second North American roster is now in the quarterfinals. I'm here with Tarek. Tarek, first of all, congratulations, man. Tell me, what were the thoughts coming into the day?
We knew we had to win this, and we knew we had to do it for NA, not only ourselves, and we knew it was going to be an important BO3. We got a good matchup for us in this group, BO3 against Gambit. Could have been Envy, so we got lucky with that, and it was really important, and I'm glad we pulled it off.
Well, speaking of Envy, you started off the tournament with a major win, an upset in a lot of people's eyes coming into the event. When you first saw the groups, how confident were you that you would be able to make it into the top eight?
Well, we knew like Envy was going through this transition phase with Devil, so we knew they were like not the sickest team right now, and we could catch them off guard, and we did do that. But Astralis has always like been a problem for us. Can't beat them, unfortunately, and one of these days we will, but it's just like they always somehow destroy us. And then Gambit was like that sort of dark horse team that we, you know, had to win against, and thankfully did.
Well, Gambit's been on the rise recently. You saw them at the major qualifier. What did you guys do to prepare to play them specifically today?
It's just like watching their demos. We don't want to focus too much on their game, but to make sure we're focused on our game. So just keep track of tendencies and like sort of like small things that they do, because we don't want to adapt to them. We want to play our game and make sure we're focused on that.
I've had some great conversations with PETA so far, your coach. Tell me, what has he brought to this squad, and how much stronger are you than previously without him in this lineup?
Yeah, I feel like PETA's helped out a lot with structure, and it's this European style that we're not familiar with, and it's coming into our NA style, so it's been different, and I'm grateful to have him, and he's been great so far.
Tell me about tomorrow, my friend. We are going to see you in Nationwide Arena, on American soil, with all the American fans watching you play another American team in Team Liquid. You've played Liquid in the past. You know these guys inside and out. How do you feel knowing that you'll have to face off against them and one of you is guaranteed to be top four?
It's super hype, and I'm really excited to play them. I wanted to play against the European team. I think it would have been cooler if like we played a European team, they played a European team, but it's going to be a super hype match, and I look forward. We have a lot of experience playing against Liquid, so we can definitely pull it off.
Any player to shut down?
Any player to shut down on Liquid? We got to shut down, I would say, like, Hiko. Hiko's a god.
And who do they have to shut down from CLG?
JDM. He's a beast.
We'll see if they can do it. Tarek, congratulations. A hell of a matchup in store for us in the quarterfinals. You can catch these guys live in Nationwide Arena starting tomorrow. Well, let's send it over to the desk to get their thoughts on this matchup.
Thanks a lot for that, Puckett. So there you had it. Tarek himself talking about how hyped he is to be playing against Team Liquid. And that's exactly what's going to happen. It's good that CLG got through. But a few words about Gambit. A little bit unlucky, because in fits and starts, you could see that they are a good team. But they just left themselves with this mountain to climb on Mirage.
I mean, unfortunately, this is one of those maps where you feel that one round completely ruined the game for Gambit. It was that fifth round, right, just after Gambit won the first gun round, they forced CLG to eco, they even get the entry kill with Mo on the AWP, and after that, Dosha is close in B-Apps, he dies, gives a rifle towards CLG and entrance into the bomb site, and that's where everything falls apart for Gambit. They're immediately forced to double eco, basically, the economy is in shambles for them, and I think they were down 7-1, something like that on the CT side, and they always had to have a strong CT side on Mirage to be able to beat CLG.
Duncan?
You just saw in this map, CLG is significantly better on Mirage. I mean, we can get that many T rounds. The problem with this map was I wasn't as impressed by Gambit overall. Like, they have managed to, like, the same players on Gambit are playing well in all the maps. They still managed to get all the frags, but it does feel like they were just in situations where I actually feel like it was CLG just can't close maps out. Like, even when they have the leads, they just give up rounds. They had a really they should have won this map quite easily, especially from the first half score that they had. Like, they were in a very dominating position, I thought. Oh, they're going to go through quite easily. But again, they start to give up rounds. They start to lose them over and over again. And there was that bizarre round where Cutler obviously couldn't defuse the bomb. So it's not really that convincing stuff. When you consider this is the first time CLG is going into the playoffs of a major, you'd expect it. When you say, oh, they'd be envious and they'll make it to the playoffs of the major, you'll think, wow, they'll be in fantastic form. You'd be thinking how great they'll be. They've actually been a bit lackluster, I think, aside from the envious game. That game was very impressive. Beyond that, not so much.
Yeah, and I think that's been the key thing with CLG, that they, for me at least, they just haven't looked convincing at any point. You get these kind of vague idea about what the team could be if everyone was firing. But again, no one ever seems to have their best days all at the same time. What stood out for you?
Well, for Gambit, I mean, first of all, they lost both pistols on Mirage. But they looked very lost overall on Mirage as well, if you compare it to the first map. Second one as well, Cobblestone. CLG was just a better team here, and they seem to be more structured as a team, because we were talking about right after they won the first map, where it's like they have that randomness in the CIS teams where they can just run through a smoke or do something unorthodox that most teams aren't really ready for, and then they also have the set tactics. On Mirage here, you didn't really see much of that. Yeah, they try, but then they noticed that it didn't really work. And then you just started running around. You saw the sluffishness come in again. No revenge frags whatsoever. And CLG took advantage of that for sure. So, yeah, overall, CLG, much better team, I'd say, the last two maps. And as Tark was saying as well, Pita, with the work, I think that actually having him on the team, if you compare it to previous tournaments where before Pita came in,
yeah,
the difference, right? So, like, overall, I think CLG still has a lot to work with or to work on. But, I mean, compared to Gambit, they're a lot more structured.
Well, the benefits of a coach there. But let's pick out some of the individual performances. We've got a highlight package for you at home. And obviously, gentlemen, you can just talk over this. Tell us what's on the screen.
I mean, JDM had an amazing series, not just the game. Even in the last game, it was him and Tarek combining for more than 50 kills. I think so. I think that's what made the difference in the end. Yeah, CLG always has a problem with closing out games, but it's also because their star players don't, you know, show up in those moments. Here, we had a different thing. Both Tarek and JDM had an amazing game.
And that's one of the differences for me. I mean, obviously, we're seeing Mo now on the Gambit side. I think he's had a very convincing major overall, particularly in this series. He's the guy who kept them in, gave them a lot of chances. But I have to say, the guy I'm going to highlight on the CLG team, I've always seen JDM as a star player, someone who was legit, aside from that slip-up at the major qualifier. But actually, this is the first time at a major I've really seen Tarek do work. Like before, he's always the guy that's gone missing, and he's always the one I thought, that's who they need more firepower from. You can't look to guys like Hazed, and in the past, FNS, and to a degree, Cutler, and go, oh, you have to be the star player every time, you have to carry the... They're not going to do that. Tarek's always had this talent that's promised as much, but it's been so long, I mean, year and a half, whatever it might be now, that it felt like, ah, he's never going to deliver it. But he's starting to get the pieces together. Now he actually starts to seem like an impact player. So if they have JDM and they have Tarek going at the same time, I mean, first of all, they're playing Team Liquid. It's not like they're playing some incredible European team. I certainly think if those two are rolling, they can be in the semifinals. That's a possibility.
Well, we got with more highlights. This is from map two, which, of course, was Cobblestone in this series. And you can see that this is Waylander, someone who, you know, maybe didn't have a great series, but did have some...
This was
moment.
The one map that he actually showed up on. I mean, on the first map, he was pretty much invisible. But this is, Waylander kept him alive here on Cobblestone. But yeah, I have to agree. I mean, JDM, sure, he missed a lot of shots even on Mirage, but it doesn't really matter. You can miss as many shots as you want as long as you get those impact kills. And that's exactly what happened throughout the course of the map, even the series. Even this one is just nutty.
Disgusting.
I don't know what to say about that one.
Yeah, the noise you made in the green room, Fifflar, and I was worried.
That's a noise Stan makes. Yes.
I was going to say, sound like something Salakis might do. But yeah, like, I want to talk a little bit about Mo or Moo or however it's pronounced. I mean, everyone's calling him Mo. I'm pretty sure it's Moo, but whatever. It doesn't matter. It's just a major. It's just one. It's just a breakout performance for him. We can't even get your name right. But he was kind of a cast-off, you know, from the Hellraisers team. And I was astounded by that at the time, but he really seems to have found his form here. And now he's actually delivering a decent level of performance, but consistency as well.
I mean, if you look at the other CIS teams we have at this current day of age, Flipside, Hellraisers, probably not Hellraisers anymore, but we'll see about that.
Yeah.
And now also Gambit. I'd say Gambit is right up there, and they're a new team. Hellers have been around for a while. Sure, they switched some players. Flipside, I'd say, kept the core five the longest. And then you have Gambit now with a new team. And if I were to like match these all together, I feel like if you compare Flipside's game versus Mousesports, it's so many mistakes, right? Mm. Sure, narrow loss to both NIP and Mousesports. Gambit, ended up beating Envy. Close series here versus CLG. I don't know. I think they have a bright future. I think they just need some more time to actually meld together a little bit. Mm.
Yeah, so we'll bring up the final set of replays here. And again, it was the JDM and Tarek show on the last map. And I don't know. I'll bring you in on this one, Duncan, because you know you've talked about how JDM's been inconsistent in the past, and yet you've also said he's got the potential to be the best AWPer in NA. So whereabouts is he going into this? Yeah. He's gonna go up against Simple and people like this.
Yeah. I mean, right now you'd have to say that I think he probably is the best NA AWPer overall. Like Simple obviously has dallied with even coming off the AWP, if we're gonna call him like a North American region play, you know. In terms of Skadoodle, I still feel like Skadoodle hasn't gotten close to that transcendent form he was in before. Yeah. Now he has rounds where he's good, but he doesn't have that like through line he had before. I always used to say about Skadoodle is it felt like anything up to like an 8 out of 10 difficulty, you just knew he was going to hit. That was money in the bank, you know. JDM's actually the guy who fits the bill for that more often now, I think. He's the guy where you really can just put him on a site, and you know that he's like a frag movie player. You send the four people towards him, and he's going to hit that one shot after the other, and he's going to put together those incredible highlight clips. Obviously, his downside compared to all the other AWPers is, as I've mentioned on past shows and in videos, is he's got a particularly weak rifle game. And that's why, I mean, think of all the kills he had in this series, all the highlights you saw with an AWP. You don't see any highlights with a rifle, and so that will still always be a weakness. Now, Gambit couldn't do a lot about it because CLG got these big streaks off, so they could always have the AWP in his hand. But that's where if Team Liquid, with a lot of fragging power on their team, remember, if they're able to really do economic damage to the guys from CLG and keep the AWP out of his hands, that really neutralizes one of the biggest weapons, figuratively and literally, over on the side of CLG.
Just a big weapon there. You seem to tail off at the end at the word just, big weapon.
I got a vision.
Yeah, I thought you might have done.
Anyway, the biggest weapons.
Any final thoughts from you guys?
Big weapons?
Let me guess. Kids commercial? Is that
no,
that,
I mean,
the honest?
Do you want to talk about something?
No, but how are you today?
No, okay, then let's cut to it.
No,
okay, I'm kidding.
Well, the thing is,
I'm a little bit sad for Gambit.
I saw on the screen when the little highlight comes up, you know, that impressive little badge sort of technology that MLG has. The name of JDM is actually Josh Marzano. You know what? I reckon Mars is the best AWPer, bar none. Listen, mate, I'm working with nothing here. Come on. This show's
running on fumes.
Comes off the air.
And the viewership dropped by about 200,000. Yeah. Okay, forget final thoughts. Let's just get out of it. I've got a final thought. Get him off this desk. Hey, so anyway, let's do it. Let's cut to commercial. We're going to take a short break. When we get back, we're going to have the final series of the day. It's going to be a cracker. It is going to be G2 versus Virtus Pro. So make sure that you join us.
Call me a rapper. I got those candy bars.